get things going last minute, but all in all, a good day. How have you
Yep,
been,
sorry about that. I'm high maintenance. No, I've been good.
No, you're fine, dude.
I've been enjoying I've been enjoying seeing people's questions for this. That's been kind of a fun thing throughout the day, seeing what people would want me to answer, and some are just pretty great, some are completely awesome, and some are wonderfully weird.
It is true. I've seen some of the questions that you have, and man, there's a plethora of them that we have to get through. Yeah,
yeah,
so let's go right into it. So for anyone that doesn't
sure.
know who you are, introduce yourself.
Let's see. People have probably seen the work of like the scrape away paintings where I have a reveal as they scrape a layer off of the painting and they can kind of see what's underneath. That's probably where people have seen me recently. I've been posting less of those and just doing kind of more 1950s vintage imagery with kind of more grotesque things applied to them, a lot of appropriation type stuff with cartoon characters and whatnot. That's probably the main stuff they've seen.
Nice. If you don't mind me asking, where'd you grow up?
I grew up in Wyoming. Don't tell anybody, man.
I
don't want
not.
to run my rep.
No, okay. Don't even worry about
I
it.
I live in Colorado
recording.
Now. Okay, good. Thank God. I can't let that get out. No, I grew up in Wyoming in a very, very small town. But actually had a really good upbringing. I always joke about Wyoming, but it was actually pretty good. Just not a whole lot in the way of getting your name up there. It's hard to do in that area. And then now I live in Colorado, so not a huge jump, just over the border.
Very nice. How old are you, man? If that's the I don't know why, but that seems like the biggest question that out of all of that have been asked. People keep asking how old you are. I want to shoot for the moon and say at least 17. You look like a young buck.
Well, all right. Your guess is 17?
Yeah.
36.
Oh, come on. I'm like two off.
You were close.
Yeah, I was very close. Second place. Nice, man.
Second place.
How long have you been doing art?
Gosh, I've been doing some type of art for most of my life. I think there's probably little drawings from like 2 years old. I kind of took a break during like the high school years, some of college. And then, I mean, there's been gaps of like 4 years of nothing, like not even a sketch. And then I'll go in waves of every day or, you know, kind of almost serial about it, where it's just like constantly. And then I'll take a year off and not even touch it.
Nice.
So yeah, I mean, it's been one of the more common themes throughout my whole life, but I definitely avoid it and also embrace it depending on the year.
So are you more like a seasonal artist where you're saying you take a year off here and there? Is it just kind of like how you feel at the time, or is it something that you're just like, I'll get to it?
It's kind of like I'll do it when I get to it. As you get older, it's just impossible to sometimes fit things in. There's so many ways to be busy with useless crap. So, I've got very important things in my life that I'm busy with. So I'm not saying it's all that, but there's just times where it's like, all right, moving into a house, moving out of a house, selling a house, you know, jobs. You got to have jobs. I mean, I don't know that many people that are living off of their art. So I've definitely had many careers, education, therapeutic, legal type stuff that keep me floating. Because one of the things that I've learned is if I don't have another job paying my bills, I play things very safe with my art. And I'm like, you know, hey, landscape, that'll sell. And that's super boring. My work really starts to slack. And that's when I start taking the huge breaks. Mm-hmm. When I'm trying to make stuff that sells. And then initially it sells. And then I just start falling into it in a little bit where it's like, okay, I'll do this, I guess. And then I just slowly fall out of love with it and resent it and just quit. So the nice thing about having a job is I don't have to worry about selling anything. I don't care about selling anything. If things sell, that's great. It's not why I do it. And it's been a huge surprise to me that people like my stuff, to be honest, because I'm, you know, not to be selfish, but I do art that I kind of want to see. Mm-hmm. So when other people, you know, I had started my Instagram feed off free. I'd never had one until about a year ago and didn't do anything with it. And mostly just followed other artists and just kind of collected people here and there. And then started posting some of my stuff without any attention. You know, I think a year ago, I think I had like 1,700 followers right now, and really struggled to get that. But yeah, I just was posting kind of technical charcoal drawings and thought, yeah, these are okay. I like them, whatever. And then as this various things in life just started happening and kind of stopped caring. I don't know if it was the beginning or the end of a nervous breakdown, but just big things in life had changed. And I thought, okay, I don't care about any of the stuff I'm painting. I'm just going to start painting horrible shit and just like, whatever. I'm just going to do whatever I want to see, whatever I'm thinking of at the time, and not really pull back. And some, mostly that was on a technical level. I hadn't really been talking about any themes or stories at that point. So yeah, I mean, it affords me to be weird and not have to worry about it. It's been nice. That's actually paid off.
Do you feel that, like, kind of going back to what you were saying, do you feel that having the motivation to sell something, because I mean, yourself included, I mean, everybody that's interested in art knows somebody who tries to make a living off of it, and then other people who are enthusiasts of it.
Yeah.
Do you feel that, I don't know, like, I don't have to worry myself personally about selling a painting. So whenever I do something, or whenever I paint or sketch something, I just do it on my own free time. Do you feel that, I don't know, that when you don't have the intention of selling something, that it actually allows you to be more creative? Or do you feel that it's kind of a half and half?
Yeah, completely. Completely. When I do something that I don't want to sell, that means I no longer care about what an audience thinks. I'm not catering to them in the sense of, well, if I make it look like this guy's dead, then that's going to gross out X amount of people, or they're going to think, oh, he's creepy, you know, whatever. And at the point where I'm just like, I'll hang this up. I don't give a shit. I'll throw it in my garage. Like, whatever. When I don't care about selling it, I don't care about the audience. And not to say that I'm being a self-centered jerk about it, but no. I don't care about if they're going to buy it, I guess. So then at that point, it's like, well, then there's nothing lost here. You know, like, I'll just paint whatever I want to see right now. Like, whatever I'm thinking about, whatever I'm visualizing, or whatever's been going on in my mind, that's what I'm going to do. And I don't care. I don't care if it sells. And then on the flip side, it's a weird thing when I complete something that's relatively personal, I don't even know what to charge for, because people do hit me up. I do sell a lot of those. Sometimes if someone's just super cool and they're like, man, I love your stuff. I got X amount of dollars. That's all I can afford, but I really want this. So I'm like, sure, that's fine. When in reality, I'd probably sell it for 10 times more to somebody else. Mm-hmm. I like that part of it too, where, go ahead.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. I'm being rude and interrupting. No, I really respect that.
You're good.
I really respect that because, you know, I've spoken to quite a few artists. First off, I'm very thankful to the people at World of Pencils for trusting me to do this, and also to yourself, Blake, for getting back to me so quick, dude. Like,
oh, sure.
And but I mean, like, doing another podcast on techniques, you talk a lot about, or you learn a lot about artists who are just, if you do not live by the brush and you do not die by the brush, then you do nothing with the brush. And it's really refreshing because, right, kind of like David Chaffetz, who's an amazing oil painter. If you know his work.
He's great.
Oh yeah. He's great. And he's such a sweetheart in person, but kind of the same thing. Like I really respect where you're going with it, because there are some people like yourself, like David, like myself, that I can relate to, as far as, you know, sometimes you just don't want to give a shit and you just want to create,
right.
You just want to have fun with it. And You know, there's arguments for both sides, but I genuinely like your approach to what you're talking about because, you know, like you said.
Thank you. And you know, over you read stuff, you get inspiring quotes and things. So I've kind of combined like just some ideas as far as how to answer that one. And I always tell, like, if I have students, I say work creates work. If you told me a year ago the stuff I'd be doing now, I would say I have no clue how I'm going to get to that. I don't understand. I have no frame of reference to that. Like, why am I painting like that? A year ago, I would not have had a clue. However, one thing that people have done, and it's kind of fun to read them, you know, talk about it, or even myself to go through and say, okay, how did I get from here to here? And sometimes it's just super little things. Like the very first, like kind of weird portrait that I did, you know, was during a vulnerable time where I did a meat face portrait where it's just my face with, what looks like a steak cut up. And you can see my eyes and teeth. And honestly, I was super embarrassed to post it because it was not technically difficult. It was not well rendered, not even that finished. But I thought, you know what? I'm done with it. That's exactly how I feel about it. Let's just do it. But I'm embarrassed. And, you know, it got a little bit of attention and I felt okay about it. And I started kind of pushing. And I said, okay, well, what's next? And then I did a painting of Emilio Villalba for death of a coworker, a project that I do where I trade portraits with other people and other artists do as well. And I started sending him stuff. Like, we're good buddies and we text back and forth, you know, hey, how's your week going? What are you listening to? That kind of stuff. And during that project, I kept sending him photos of these drawings, of these paintings. And I'd be like, what do you think of this? And, you know, he's the nicest dude on the planet. He's like, no, that's great, man. And I'd do another one. He's like, no, that's great. And he, you know, very sincere. But I knew I didn't nail it. I knew that I needed that, like, up it a little bit. But by doing that, I needed to, like, change the game completely and do. And so I did a portrait of him where it was the opposite of everything that I want to do. Meaning I render out lips, teeth, eyes, nose, blah. I took out the nose. I took out any shading whatsoever by just having a matte black outline and just rendered the eyes and did some silly teeth. And he was like, that's the one. And I was like, I feel pretty good about it too, man. This is weird. Like, this is not where I thought. But because I did that meat face portrait before that and focused on the teeth and kind of like that look. And then I jumped to kind of the dark silhouette paintings of just the teeth and eyes. And I did a handful of those. Jumped to the next thing where it was kind of like these zombie characters and then jumped to the superheroes. And it was all based off of like, okay, then I do this and I do this and I do this. And so the work created work. I never would have just said, I'm going to do this because I don't think an artist's brain really works that way. If you're sitting planning on a style, you're going to make a lot of synthetic experiences, meaning like it's not going to be a real thing to you. You're trying to make it a style, which is fine. But I think viewers and more critical viewers will say, I don't feel anything with this. It doesn't feel sincere versus like kind of trudging through the mud and saying like, okay, that sucks, but I do like the way I painted the eyes here. Okay, I'm going to try that with something else. And then next, 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 next. And then by the end of 30 paintings, you're in a whole other planet than where you started off. And hopefully it's a better place, but I promise you it'll be a more sincere place. So by just doing more work and work that makes you feel happy about doing, meaning not necessarily like, oh, pretty flowers, I'm happy. More like, I feel accomplished and I feel great about doing this. I felt I was in the flow and I felt like it all made sense for a minute there. Mm-hmm. That's kind of what I mean. And then, okay, do that again. And like I said, at the end of 30 or 50, then at a point you'll be like, okay, I'm starting to understand my own lineage here of my art, and I'm creating my own character arc through these people or through this style or through these themes. I think that's where you get it. You from like the most sincere place and just keep building off of it. Take it somewhere else. It's not going to work. Take it that way. That doesn't work. Take it this way. Okay, that worked. And really, it's just building up on your failures and finding the successes and then kind of piecing them all together towards the end.
Yeah, no, that's that's extremely true. You posted that one that you were talking about with Emilio 53 weeks ago. I'm looking at it right now online. And,
oh, nice. And oh, really?
Yeah. Well, I got squinty eyes, man. I'm pretty good with technology. You know how that goes. But it's amazing to see the pieces you're doing and almost the deconstruction of it, because the first 9 pieces on your Instagram are very well illustrative pieces, and the 2 astronauts are my favorite. I love the attention to detail, but the looseness of them. And
oh, thanks.
And they're great. And then all of a sudden you see this really nice color. It almost looks like a pastel piece that you did of a gentleman with a beard.
Benjamin Bjorklund.
I believe so. Let me see.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that is it. To go from there, then it starts kind of deconstructing all the way down to where it just starts going into this huge lineage of different pieces. And like you're saying, what you're kind of going through artistically now, and it's outstanding to see the transformation, because like you said, you know, you get to a point in art where I think a lot of people, like, let me rephrase this. You said it perfectly, where I see people on a consistent daily basis, whether it be on Instagram or whether it be Facebook, or even like when you go to conventions and you see them and they're just always trying to figure out their niche. You know, it's the best way I can explain it is there's always a gimmick. You know, there's always something.
Right.
And there's the storytellers, there's the imitators, there are the abstractors, the second age cubists, as Ant-Man has showed us. And so many other things. And you realize that, like you said, sometimes taking chances on different pieces and just, oh, you know what? I don't like that. Every single time you sketch something and you find something you don't like, you're always going to find one little thing that you feel that you do like, and to kind of take that and move forward. Do you think that that was a little bit harder for you? Because, I mean, your illustrations are, I mean, genuinely awesome. I mean, they're rad. You know how to sketch, you know how proportion works and lighting and so forth, but you're kind of taking everything away, you know, from what you're basically have worked for, and you're kind of just minimalizing it. Was that harder for you, or was that just something, like you said, as you kind of did it, you started taking away more and more?
You know, that's a good question. I feel like it's kind of like I don't even know if it's Picasso, but I think he gets quoted with it, but you have to know the rules, how to break them,
and then ignore them.
What's that?
Learn all the rules and then basically ignore them, or something like that. Break the rules.
Exactly. Yeah. So it's kind of like that. I think on a lot of levels, like especially when I was in college, I was kind of just buying time to not have to like tell a story or to talk about myself. It was more like focus on the technique. And so it was just me buying time before. I almost felt like a fraud back in those days. and confidence also is kind of like a muscle that needs to be worked. Like you have to build that up over and over again. Like the paintings I'm doing now, 3 years ago, I never would have the guts to display them for fear that I would like gross people out or offend them or whatever. And it's just an interesting process to kind of go through all that and be on the back end of it, not knowing that I would be doing this stuff now. And I would not be worried. You know, I was so worried about technical stuff because that's all I had.
Well, let me ask
you. I didn't have a deep. Yeah.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Continue.
I was just going to say all I had was technical stuff. But at the same time, growing up in Wyoming, and this is going to sound weird, but there wasn't a whole lot of internet around, especially with my age. You know, I'm in that age group of people where we were alive longer without the internet than when we were. So aside from library books, museums, I didn't really see a whole lot of other art for most of my life. Like I would see the Picassos, the Warhols, and I would gravitate towards that stuff and never saw anything else, never really heard other music. So when I went to college, I remember just still being in that bubble and then moving away and doing, you know, being in more kind of progressive areas and then seeing other artists and seeing artists like Jeremy Lip King, Sean Cheatham, these guys who are just pretty much the best painters, Nicholas Uribe, like these guys are just like, I mean, they're on top of their game so much that you can't compete with them.
Right.
And so that actually, seeing their work inspired me to like want to learn how to paint because I didn't paint up until a few years ago. Mm-hmm. And when I saw their work, I was like, oh my God, you can do that? Like this isn't like 400 years old, like technical painters like Rembrandt. And like these guys are alive right now. Holy crap. Like I've never seen these colors, like these muted greens and blues and these flesh tones. Like this is insane. I've never seen this before. And because I went back for a 10-year reunion, and an old high school buddy that we were art friends said, have you ever heard of these guys? I've never, you know, and I said, no, I haven't. And we started watching all these videos. And we think they each had like two or three videos of like, you know, sped up painting demos or something. And we watched them over and over and over again. And it inspired me to be like, I want to learn how to paint if this can be done. And then the more I saw their stuff, it just, it's so good. I sound like I'm gushing, but it so good.
I was just going to say, you know, I totally agree with you because I feel that people genuinely think that what was your awe moment? What was the thing that was going to pull you and just tell you, I want to be an artist? But I mean, speaking of Sean Cheatham, like he's one of my favorite painters and he has a time lapse that he did in LA. And I don't know if you had, I don't know if you've watched it, but it's the one where he's doing the guy with the red shirt. It's like it's a gentleman, but
he had the beard. He's kind of overweight.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Same thing. You know, you're watching it and on repeat all day, every day for like a week.
And it's like 12 minutes long or something.
Exactly. You're seeing him push that paint and shape that brush and, you know, start cutting and carving into paint, doing the alaprimas. And looking at some of your work, I'm looking at the Batman, Flash, and Superman, and it's really kind of apparent where you like that loose style of painting, and it's true. People always are like, man, if I just get this, or if I just do that, you know, or if I just go to this thing, I'll be inspired. It's like, no, there's inspiration everywhere. I mean, shit, that's a free YouTube video right there. Yeah. Check out.
Right. Yeah. I mean the. Some of the best painters are alive right now. Mm-hmm. I'm convinced there's probably five or six people alive right now that'll go on to be like the next greatest, you know, they'll be in every museum. People will travel all over to see them. Do your research, find out who you like, obsess over them, figure out how they did it, buy their books, buy their prints, save up money, buy their paintings. Because if you see how somebody does something and then you see it in person, I mean, it's like a otherworldly experience type thing of like, wow, I can't believe it. That's where, that's how that final layer looks. So that's how they put in the whites. Like, oh my gosh, it's crazy.
Yeah.
I mean, that kind of stuff, you can't see enough of that stuff. Like now, I mean, I got to a point where I was seeing so many artists that I kind of lost my direction. So you can kind of have that issue where you're just like, gosh, I'm going to rip everybody off now. Like, I know exactly, you know, I was doing the King's Blue, Benjamin Bjorklund, like I'm gonna draw a line right there like he does. And then, you know, you just kind of, you like what you like and you just put it in and that's okay. Give him credit. And then try to take it and make it your own thing and move on with it.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, you know, I think the other thing too, going back to Lip King, Cheatham, guys like that, Nicholas Alm, he's incredible. Stephen Bauman's pretty great. I think that's how you say his name. And you look at their stuff, they're so good. They're so good. For a guy like me that relied on technical stuff, the more I started painting and the more I'd see their work, what made me want to start painting eventually made me quit painting. Because I'd looked at so much of their work and I said, I'm never going to get there. Like, I will never, and I really won't. I mean, that's just a whole other function of their brain and their hand that's doing that stuff. Like, you can practice all day long, but I don't know if you could ever get to the, I can't, I personally can't. And so I knew that. And so I thought, well, then what am I doing here? Like, I'll never get to that level. So I don't really care anymore, because if technique was the thing that I was trying to go for, I don't have it. I can't compete. And so that's when I really, really started dropping off and probably quit for about 4 years. Until, you know, a little over a year ago did I start picking it back up again. And then thought, okay, well, if I can't go that route, I really can't, what's my thing? So I had to really go internally and just say, what, everything's been done in art, every single thing. Like, I'll think I've done some original, and then I'll look at somebody and I'm like, oh shit, they did that in 1982. Oh, okay. Or, oh, look at this. And then you see somebody else is doing it in London, like, oh crap. You know, and I think most everything is done, that's fine. Mm-hmm. If everything's been done, what's your version of it?
Right.
You know, like, no one's ever been you in the world, so how are you going to take your experiences? You know, if we're all looking at the same glass of water and we're going to paint it, like, how are you going to bring everything you've ever known in your life to make that unique instead of, you know, photorealistic or whatever. So that's kind of where I come with things now, where it's like, okay, so what part of this is valuable to me when I do a painting? Like, is it the humor? Is it the dark humor? Is it the fear? Is it the deconstruction? So many things that I try to just, what's the most me I can do? Because a lot of people, I mean, like I said, everything's been done. But a lot of people right now, it's one of those things, I'll do a handful of them and then I look around and I'm like, oh shit, people have been doing these for a while. You know, there's been a handful of people where they do the bondage masks, which are just these beautiful, awesome designs. And I love painting them. And then you see other people doing it. The old me would have been like, I quit. I'm not doing these anymore because so-and-so has been doing them. But now I'm like, you know what? I'm not going to quit that because that's something that I want to have portrayed in my art. So whatever. I'm just going to roll with it. If people think I'm copying or if other people are copying me, like, I don't care. I'm just going to do this right now for as long as it's relevant to me.
Well, do you think that that's a huge thing that's come because of the technological advances that we've had in the past 30 years? You know, because if you think about it, the more that you see art these days, the more unoriginal some people feel about art. And I understand what you're saying because
right.
I'm in the same boat where I would look at Cheatham's work. I would look at Emilio's work. I would look at a lot of different people's work. I still look at their work. And I learned a long time ago from artists like Kate Zambrano. You know, she's a total sweetheart from the East Coast. And she said, you know, I can't have anyone's artwork in my workspace because it's going to influence mine. And you know, and that can come in the form of having someone's art you've collected or having your phone and just looking through Instagram. And I think personally that people all of the world have been kind of mimicking each other. And I don't want to say mimicking, that's the wrong word, but like you, everyone has had at least the same idea. There's like a group of people, somebody that thinks that their, excuse me, their idea is there. I guarantee someone else has looked at it, but it's more visible now to see someone else do something like that.
Right.
And I do agree though, that if you don't take a chance on something after a while and you're like, oh man, doing this, doing that, you're not going to learn. Because I mean, if you look at, for back to the example that you and I can relate on, is like Cheatham, you look at his work and then you start learning people that he's inspired by and you're like, oh, a
right.
lot of his stuff looks just like theirs. And then if you look at those people and their influences, so on and so forth, you know, like there's a lineage of inspiration.
There is, yeah.
But they do take those little things that they admire and say, you know what, fuck it. I'm going to go ahead and take it and move forward and see what I can create with it.
Right, yep. So, yeah, and I think...
Go ahead.
Yeah, and that's... And it, yeah, it is this kind of balance of like... And I know people are like, I can't see anybody else's work. I don't even look at my feed. I just do my own stuff. And I see the value of that. And for me, like, there's something I do where, you know, I'm slightly obsessed with collecting art. So I'll have, in my studio, I've got this whole wall of, like, you know, some of the best painters on the planet. And I've got originals, which is, I still can't believe. But I have them looking at me, and I not in the sense of like, I'm going to copy this Phil Hale painting right now, mm-hmm. but I have it say like, what would Phil Hale, and this is, sounds like a bumper sticker. What would Phil Hale think? But, or, you know, what would Benjamin Bjorklund think of the painting I'm working on right now? And honestly, a lot of the times my mind, I'm like, they wouldn't like this, but they would probably respect that it actually came from somewhere, that I really cared about and could, you know, talk to them about it. And they'd be like, oh, that is cool. It's, you know, I think it's cheesy or whatever, or I don't like your application or whatever. I mean, they're nice guys. Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
But I mean, like, I always think, would they think that these paintings are coming from an authentic place? But I don't look at them to think, cause you can't copy Bjorklund's style.
No.
I mean, the dude is like the best. He, in my opinion, he's the gold standard. He's the best.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got, he's one of my favorite people on the whole planet. And, we've done workshops together and, you know, I've got a bunch of his original paintings and I just look at him and I'm like, how do you do that? I don't know how he does it. He has such a unique style. I've never seen anything like it. And he's actually, I'm probably jumping into a whole new thing here, but he's the whole reason I started doing what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'd never seen, I'd given up completely on art. And I was like, I'm just going to be a day job guy. I don't even, whatever. I'm not even going to do this. And it had been about 4 years. My wife said, hey, do you ever get on Instagram? I said, no, I don't do that. She's like, you should check it out. It's kind of like every artist's sketchbook. Like everybody posts stuff. I mean, like real deal artists. And my tattoo artist had said the same thing that right around the same time. And I was like, okay, maybe I will check it out. And she says, you got to check out this guy named Benjamin Bjorklund. And I thought, well, I'm kind of an art snob. I probably won't like it. And then I saw it and was just blown away. To the point where I was like obsessed with it. I would just check all the time. Like, oh, I posted something new. My gosh, this is incredible. And jumping back to that, the technology thing, you know, he's a guy I would have read about, you know, when I'm 60 years old, probably like, oh, look at this guy, this huge retrospective. And, you know, he's this famous artist from Sweden. Wow. I wish I had known about him earlier, but because of Instagram, like I know about him. And I was able to actually hit him up, start talking to him and buy some of his paintings. And, you know, it was just like this, it's kind of a surreal thing to, you know, and then once I started getting his paintings and seeing them, it just like really fueled me to start. Okay. You can still paint really well and tell a weird story, and that's okay. Cause I'd never seen anybody paint really well and not, and be kind of bizarre about it.
I like,
so way... seeing that, it just,
go ahead.
Go ahead.
Now, I was going to say, I really like the way that your wife put that though. It's true. Cause I don't think I've ever been, I don't think I've ever heard it been put that way, is that Instagram is literally like a world's rendition of a giant art book. Or a sketchbook.
Yeah. Yeah, it really is.
So continue.
Yeah, it's pretty great. Like once he opened up the doors, I started seeing so many other people. I was like, oh my gosh, you guys have been here this whole time and I never saw you, you know, like, because I didn't even know where to look. But yeah, for every time Ben posts something, it just blows my mind. It's my favorite painting until the next one he posts.
Well, like Emilio's stuff, I love Emilio's as well, because like it's really cool to see you guys working together, as I've seen the flyers for it. Because he has such a vibrancy to his work, plus the doubling of like noses or eyes or so forth plays a real big optical illusion of what your eyes want to see, you know, as to where your painting has a very, very nice palette of color. But at the same time, as you have, I mean, without, you know, no pun intended, but you have layers of storytelling on top of that. And so it's really nice. Yeah. I know. Bazing.
Right.
So let's go back.
Yeah. And I think it's cool.
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, go ahead.
A lot of people listening, I'm like, God damn it. Just quit saying, go ahead.
Quit being so polite to each other.
Yeah, exactly. You guys suck.
Yeah. Well, the cool thing about Emilio's stuff is that his particular style is relatively new to him. Mm-hmm. So you can go through his feed and do the same thing where you're like, oh, okay. Then he started taking this out. Then he started adding this, and there's blue, and then there's this. You know, like, you can see where he's picking up things where it's like his very first few are different than what he's doing now. Mm-hmm. It's still his hand and his style, you can tell, but I love seeing his progression where it's like you'll be going along and then you're like, white. All of a sudden I see white and it's so like dramatic. And then he'll go back to dark stuff and then he'll add reds and, you know. So I love that too. We're kind of invited along to see the process. And so I really like when you see artists kind of gutting it out and like, all right, let's try to make this work and let's power through it. And beautiful paintings.
So let's go back a little bit, man.
When
did you first start doing art?
I took it pretty seriously like my senior year in high school, and by doing like watercolors, kind of comic book stuff. I really loved it. I thought, okay, I'm going to go to college for this. But again, not knowing what was out there in the rest of the world, I was not well equipped. I mean, I my shit was horrible. You know, it was good for a small town in Wyoming probably, but you know, you compare me to someone going to Art Center or something. It's like, wow, this is adorable. Please never come back. Don't apply ever again, type thing. So senior year was big. And then right towards the end of college. So I probably had about 5 years where it's like, okay, this is me taking it seriously. And then, up until last year. So really I started sketching and drawing and doodling for, you know, from like 2 years old to 10 years old. A lot, and then kind of quit as you do sports and you know, worry about like your social life and all that stuff.
Did at that time, like when you when you're saying you were thinking of going to college for it, who were some of the people that were inspiring you?
It was only like nobody. I couldn't tell you a single living artist at that time. You know, it was mostly like going to libraries or, you know, like someone's showing me Salvador Dali. You're like, oh, okay, that's great. Ralph Steadman was somebody that I really liked. I liked Sebastian Kruger. He was a great one. So just things that were very accessible to somebody in the small town. You know, you weren't hearing about Phil Hale in Wyoming. You know, not for a long time, even though he was around doing this thing. You were hearing about Ashley Wood or any of those guys for a long time. So it was kind of left to go into a Barnes and Nobles and what book could you find? Like, okay, here's a Picasso. I'll grab it. Sure, whatever. You know, like, it was mostly greatest hits. Mm-hmm. You couldn't find any kind of smaller niche people. So I just wanted to go and make art because it was fun. I didn't have any direction or anything. So if it wasn't a comic book or, you know, some overproduced book about art, I didn't know about it.
Right. So do you, I mean, with being in a small town, like, do you feel that a lot of the stuff that you were learning in high school going on into college, because you can tell from like you said, you were very concerned about technical application and everything in drawing. Did a lot of that come because of the material you had back then? Like, you know, myself, I'm a huge comic book collector, and
yeah,
I find myself looking and being attracted to, like, you know, Vincent Sunico or Alex Ross or Drew Struzan stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh man, that would be so great to do this and do that. But, you know, when you're adapted to those kind of influences, you start thinking about, well, this is how I'm going to draw it like them. And then you start realizing that you're basically just doing what they're doing versus having to experiment. Yeah. So do you feel like that was kind of you, since you had only had, like you said, the greatest hits, you were kind of pushed in that way of doing that? Or was it that just something that was the flavor of the month, so to speak, at that point in your life?
Well, you know, it's funny. Like, I loved all that stuff, but I was still just mostly doing charcoal drawing, mm-hmm. the portrait, which nothing really informed my drawings. It was just like love for art. It was almost like, I love movies. You know, it was like a whole other subject versus like what I was actually doing. So I could look at Salvador Dali and Picasso and all these things, and then I wouldn't really transfer it to anything else. My dad is a very prolific charcoal artist, mm-hmm. Just fantastic, one of the best out there. And so whenever I always saw him doing it and thought, that's just what you do. Like, that was fun for him, and that's fun for me, and that's just what, you know, a grown man does type thing. And, you know, he always had a job, but he did it on the side, so I could tell that was kind of like his release. So it was almost like, that's my release, and that's my thing too, and I like all this other stuff, but they don't ever meet. But then I started getting into more comic books, like Jim Lee and Todd McFarlane. Their heyday was like when I was really into stuff. Mm-hmm. So,
like the early 90s.
I tried to, yeah, and I tried to get into their stuff, but again, like, you can't really draw a Spawn and have it be your own.
Right.
You can do, you know, like some Sam Keith versions of that and have it be kind of like abstract. But so I just knew that it couldn't be my own if I was doing that. And I was very worried about ripping people off. Hmm. You know, I was kind of like the first to call people out on it. So I knew I couldn't be that guy. So like, if I was just going to do a study of, like, you know, here's the cover of X-Men 1 with Wolverine doing, you know, I would do anything with it. It was just like practice.
No, I totally agree with you on that. I personally, myself, I'm going through that mode where, you know, I've loved and lived for movies and comics my whole life, but you get to that point where it's like, all right, here's the 15th, like, hunt. Well, right now Logan's the biggest thing, you know, Wolverine, and you're seeing,
right.
Yeah, you're, and don't get me wrong, that was a great movie. I mean, I was.
I gotta see it.
Oh my god, I cried. I cried, and my girlfriend made me feel like a little bitch. But I thought I was dating a man.
It's all right, man. Let it out.
Oh god, I'm so alone. I was watching it, and then, you know, I in my mind automatically, as I'm in the movie, I'm thinking, man, how many Logan paintings and renditions am I going to see that people are going to paint, as well as how many am I going to see that are just the same thing, him standing in front of something, or him,
right,
you know. And you look on Instagram, right, over the past 2 weeks, and it's legitimately just swarms of the same thing. And it starts getting to that point where, as an artist, you look at other works of art and you think, like, you know,
right.
I know quite a few comic book artists that work for DC and Marvel, as well as people aspiring to, and they love adding their flair. You know, people love Mike Mignola and are like, hey man, Hellboy's my favorite piece. But
yep.
I don't think certain people after a certain time enjoy doing the same thing over and over? I mean, if you see something 1500 times, right, like let's say the Logan piece, how is yours going to stand out to yourself and to others, depending on how right. you want to be artistic?
Yeah. Yeah, I think what's interesting about that too is like you can kind of track those trends mm-hmm. where it's like, okay, Logan's huge. And then people start getting sick of Logan. Then they're like, well, Wolverine's still cool. We can't do Logan. We can't do Wolverine. Let's do Weapon X.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, you know what I mean? Like, and then Weapon X stuff will be, and then all of a sudden you have people doing like one-offs of that where it's like a dude hooked up to like biomedical equipment and blah, 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 you know, and you can just check, you know, kind of track these trends off of just one little thing like that, where like here's this movie bringing this back into people's, you know, awareness, like Deadpool. Mm-hmm. I remember him from years and years ago not being hardly anything.
Yeah.
Wasn't he originally X-Force or something? I feel like he was X-Force. You could yeah. get his card with...
This is the part, everybody, where we become nerds. Yeah, well, especially, like, I remember reading him...
And everybody could tune out at this yeah, point. Yeah,
exactly. They're all... now we got a fat guy and an artist over here talking about it. But, he came out... I remember reading him in 92, 93... And I've been a Deadpool fan forever, and even with like New Mutants or you know with the Task Force X stuff, and all the way down when you start reading a lot about the artist in general, it's a great thing.
Yeah.
Now when Deadpool came out, I made a conscious effort to not ever draw or paint something to just be like, hey guys, by the way, look at mine, because I have a friend who's an artist, and this ties into what you're saying. It's like no one gave two shits about Deadpool, you know, back in the day. I mean, there are some people out there that'll even be listening that are like, oh yeah, you know, Deadpool is my jam. But before it came into the modern hierarchy of where it is now, I mean, even in that god awful Wolverine origin story or whatever movie that was. But you know, I honestly believe that they got Ryan Reynolds to do the best possible thing. You had people who genuinely cared about it. But then, as artists, you see people who have been drawn in for years that got no love, that got no recognition. And then you have, well, the friend I'm talking about was like, dude, okay, I'm going to do a series of Deadpools. And then you're going to see it that, like, I'm going to sell, like, 15 prints. So that's all I need to make if I do it for this much. Like, it was this business decision because it was going to be popular for that moment. And I was like, well, why don't you just draw them to draw them? I'm a firm believer that whether it be comic books, whether it be art, whether it be movies, whatever it may be, you know, tattoos, if you are not new to something and you're barely getting into it, even if it's because of a movie or if you've been reading it for 20 years, just enjoy it, you know, just enjoy it.
Right.
You got to shit on someone else's parade. But that day, my friend, I did not take my own advice, and I shit all over him. I was like, you don't give two shits about me. Who are you? Get out of my face, nerd.
Right, right.
But,
Yeah,
and
that's the thing. You kind of got to figure out,
No, go ahead.
Yeah, and you got to figure out, like, who people are, like, super passionate about. And, mm-hmm. you know, like, certain comic book things, like, don't jump on that because people will eat you up.
Yeah.
One thing I'm careful of, mostly because I'm not super in love with it, not like other people are, but like so many people, I mean, there's probably, no lie, like 2,000 people have told me, like, please do a Heath Ledger Joker. And it was just fine. Like, I don't want to be a jerk and like not honor, you know, like, oh, that, thank you, that's a good idea, you know.
Yeah,
but I can't do it. I'm not gonna jump, you know. The Joker one that I did was almost like a joke. But like a joke of like, I'm not going to do the Joker you guys want. I'm going to do the other Joker.
Right.
The Jack Nicholson one that no one really cares about anymore, it seems like. But so that was kind of my joke, but I don't think anybody caught it, which is fine.
Oh, I did. I was but in the entire time.
Jump into it. Yeah. I can't jump into the Heath Ledger Joker stuff because that's a whole culture. Like the Joker people. I mean, that's a thing. You don't jump into that unless you're like super into it. And I don't want to appear to be like a guy that's like, let's make some money off of this.
Yeah, I
you know,
I respect that because of the same thing. I'm, I grew up with 66 Batman on VHS every morning. So, you know, Ledger Joker, and I'm going to say this, everyone can go and hate me. You can say whatever you want, but I didn't care for him. Like, you can say all you want. Those are great movies, but the worst Batman ever. Uh-huh. And I did not care for him, but he was a great Joker. Oh, I'm going to get so much hate mail. But it's the idea of, like, I respect him for doing the role. I thought it was cool. It was a different take. You know, I even love, I love any rendition of any comic book character. I mean, I have to try because Jesus Christ, I'm going to enjoy it. And I mean, I'm a big guy, man. My heart may give out in 2 years. I got to get what I can get. But, I do agree with it too. It's like, I've never drawn one, and I totally understand, because, you know, somebody a while ago, actually the artist I had mentioned earlier, Vince Unico, that dude is a legitimate comic book artist. The dude can draw anything and draw well, you know, and he says it himself, you know, he goes, you know, I do my sketches, I do this, I do that, but I really have fun when I have an idea in my head. And he drew the Bane from The Dark Knight Returns, Tom Hardy. And was that Tom Hardy? Yeah. He drew him versus Adam West Batman for me as a gift. And it was the funniest thing ever. And he was just like, you know, that's fun. That's cool. But I can't, you know, I just got to do what I got to do. And I think when you start, you know, like you said, you have a lot of people, and it's no disrespect, asking you to do, come on, man, just do this. He's like your Joker. It's going to be the sickest thing ever. Jesus. You know, when you have people doing that, you know, all of a sudden, it's kind of the same idea of, like, well, because it's popular, I kind of don't want to do it, you know? It's kind of like almost like a rebellious act. But
yeah. And I think a perfect example of trying to jump on that bandwagon was the movie Suicide Squad. Like, to me, like, and again, if you love the movie, that's great. Yeah. It was entertaining. I sat through the whole thing. But particularly the Joker version of that was them trying to guess what people wanted, to do all these cool things and have Jared Leto, like, being super weird on set, you know, on the set, and, like, doing weird things when he went to, you know, Conan O'Brien or whoever he went on, and, like, wow, he's so weird, and, like, wow, that's really what we wanted. And then you see the movie, he's in it for like 7 minutes, and it's like the shittiest, it's like the one of the worst characters I've ever seen in any movie.
Oh my God.
And it was like them, like, okay, like, let's do tattoos. Let's do cool model hair. Let's do this, this, this. And, like, they tried to guess, like, if you guys like that Joker, oh my God, you're going to love this Joker by, like, doing this fake synthetic version.
We're going to put damage on his forehead, and you're going to get that it's edgy. Wow. You're right. Jesus
Christ. Like, Joker with tattoos? How did we never do that? Guys, this is genius.
I
have tattoos, wouldn't he?
Yeah, exactly. I know this sounds weird, but let's put some tattoos on him. I swear to God, no fat guy and a really cool artist from Colorado was ever going to talk shit on this on a podcast. I guarantee it.
Yeah, we have nailed this, guys. Oscars. And so it just super annoyed me, because I hate when people try to guess and just make something super awesome.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like the last time, so the movie Fight Club, I think, is, I love it. Perfect movie, in my opinion. Brad Pitt was on this whole, like, I'm not going to be a pretty guy anymore, I'm going to be an interesting guy. And he did a really good job of that. And then the movie Troy, do you remember that one?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Where it was like, let's make Brad Pitt so fucking awesome. Like, just make him super rich and super deadly and super, and then, it's just like, this is the stupidest shit I've ever seen. Like, he's got, like, a Cockney English accent, and he's supposed to be like, like, what are we doing here, guys?
So
like,
you're not
sure, he looks great.
You're telling me you're not the only person in the world that legitimately looks at movies of ancient times, and I was like, man, everybody with a British accent, huh? Man, they, God save the
queen. I know, like, it's so ridiculous. Like, hello, fellow Romans. Like, wait, excuse me, what?
Well,
is that your Shakespearean accent?
He's like, dost thou with want to see my Trojan horse? Went, no, buddy. I want my $13 back, you jerk. Do you feel, because like especially with a lot of your works, you know, you've done comic book pieces, you've done Disney pieces, you've done even up to your recent series, you have a lot of influence in pop culture. When you watch something, like for example, you know, one thing that I've been working on myself, just to paint and study, is Dick Tracy. That's a huge movie that I loved as a kid. You know, that, The Rocketeer, older movies back in the early 90s and 80s. But,
right.
Do you feel that, like, when you see something that kind of influenced you and you have your own little take on it, is that something because it's personal and, like, you know, you're thinking back on or you're nerding out over, or is it just something that's kind of on the whim?
It depends. They can have two functions. The superhero series I did was exclusively just to make fun of their names. Mm-hmm. Like, I thought, like, you know, when you really think about it, no one thinks about the name Superman. They're just like, yeah, Superman. Mm-hmm. But if you break it down, it's like that's just the most basic-ass superhero. Like, that's just so cheesy. And then, like, Captain America? Mm-hmm. And, like, all these things where it's like, did you guys even think about this at all? Like, did anybody just have any, you know, so, you know, I was just sitting around joking with somebody about it. And I was just like, yeah, Lieutenant Earth, Captain America, what, you know, like, and just like redoing all the names. And I thought, yeah, Speedy McJargerton. I thought, I'm just going to just do something. Like, I'm going to, as stupid as the name came up with, I'm going to make a stupid painting to equal it. And so a lot of those were just jokes. And I was surprised anybody even liked them. So it just came from, like, let's do something silly. Let's not take this so seriously. Let's be weird, you know, and let's make fun of shit because that's one of my favorite things on the planet because I hate myself. Just kidding. Not really. but some of the other stuff, is I've used it later. Some of the Mickey Mouse imagery, some of the stuff I'm working on that's going to be posted pretty soon is more of – I like the idea of things that we held tightly to our childhood that represented goodness to us and putting them in a position of that doesn't really exist in this world. Mm-hmm. So if I could kind of put into my, you know, if I had an artist theme currently, it's we came into this planet, this life, whatever, as good people. The world doesn't care about that. The rat race doesn't care about that, and it changes us. And the more we get older, the more we see about all the lies that we were raised on believing, that work hard, good things will happen, blah, blah, blah.
Right.
Like, no, this shit is all messed up, all of it. Like, you know, I really want to do more of a series on Native Americans, First People, because, I mean, that's a perfect example of something that in America we think, you know, you go to school, you learn about Native Americans, you learn about tribes, and sure, there's that apostrophe, you know, there's the asterisk at the bottom that says, well, we did some messed up shit, but we gave them a bunch of land, and we're cool, whatever, and we gave them this narrative of, like, people that lived off of the earth, peaceful people, blah, blah, blah. You know, we tell the story of, like, yeah, they sure were great, weren't they? And but at the same time, it's like, so then why did we kill all of them?
Right.
You know, why do we do these horrible things? The more you read about some of this stuff, like where I grew up, there's a lot of really interesting history there. And it's hard to, you know, you hear about, oh, here's the battle of whatever. And you're like, okay, that's cool. What happened? Oh, that's where the cavalry came and shot 154 women and children because they saw the wrong symbol on their tents and just unloaded. Like, oh, what? Why the hell is this name, like this beautiful creek name that can we, you know, like, so, I mean, it's just all these things that, Trail of Tears, you know, like these horrible, horrible things that, you know, after 200 years, all become jokes or all become these things nobody cares about. There's no truth to them. There's no, it has no frame of reference. Doesn't mean anything to anybody anymore. So it's kind of like, whatever, here's this, here's that. And I was reading a book talking about, like, it's probably the largest genocide in the modern world is what happened to the Native Americans. Mm-hmm. There were concentration camps here. There's estimates of 30 million that were killed off of starvation due to, I think at one point we were killing like 3,000 buffalo a day, but they couldn't get to them. We were just slaughtering them and leaving them to rot. We gave them blankets with diseases, and we gave that guy a college named after him. Just all this stuff. So much devastation, and nobody knows about it. Like, you talk to any kids, like, what happened to Native Americans? I don't know.
Yeah.
But if you said, what happened to Jewish people in the 1940s? Oh, my God, this, that, you know, horrible things happened, and we know a lot about it. But what people don't realize also is that one of Hitler's biggest heroes was Andrew Jackson. Mm-hmm. And he said, that's a guy that's got some principle and who believes in some shit, who can get stuff done. I'm going to base, you know, Auschwitz and a lot of those were based off of things that we did to Native Americans here. And yet we have these cartoons, Pocahontas, all these things where it's like, it's just so disingenuous, the whole thing.
You're telling me that there's no, you know, singing, like, trees in Montana?
No, there are.
Or Wyoming or Colorado.
It's hard to find.
Okay. I was worried for a second. No,
that shit is real, dude.
The singing trees. I'm like, just take this tab, bro. You know what? But you're so right though, because the best way I could ever think to explain, especially because to my younger nieces, you know, they grew up around 2000, 2004. Is that the most important thing that we still have in our culture, in my opinion, are books. You know, we're so used to reading a BuzzFeed article or Huffington Post, and the smartest way I've ever heard it explained was to try to narrow down an entire lexicon of knowledge into four paragraphs or into a slideshow is utterly ridiculous.
Right.
You know, and in today's age, you know, you see things that pertain, like a lot of your paintings as of recent have a good message behind them, and in the sense of like there is a story or there is an idea, and most of that can be attained by what you're studying. You know, there's so much history out there, and people are, like you said, they're always looking for the next Logan piece or Deadpool or the next, you know, how can I make my thing go from there? And sometimes it's as easy as picking up a book and reading about what you're interested in and making those gears turn to say, you know what, this is exactly what's in my mind about this situation. And it's awesome, because as I'm hearing you speak about what your mind focuses on, it makes more sense to see what you're focused on painting wise.
Right. Yeah. Like, I love history. I love the bullshit of history. I love, like, the polished version that we tell people, because, God, we're so embarrassed we actually did. Here's the real version. Up to, you know, protecting people that did horrible things, like, or people we don't care about. Like, the PTSD Joe, the G.I. Joe thing I did, I was really nervous about posting it, because I didn't want people to think the wrong way. But it's like, you know, how can I show a very simple story and really shock people with it to realize that this actually happens. This is what this looks like. Instead of, like, you hearing somebody, oh, they died. Mm-hmm. No, they shot themselves in the face. Their head exploded. Their brother had to come clean up the mattress because the landlord wouldn't do it. They had to come throw it away. They had to get body, you know, like, hazmat stuff to cut. Like, it's the visceral real stuff that's just fascinating to me. That's part of the whole process, the whole, you know, the sadness to it. You know, as I worked in the past with therapeutic stuff, I worked with a lot of people that had issues and had a lot of people that committed suicide. And it's just a blip in a newspaper. So-and-so died, blah, blah, blah. It's like, yeah, but you know what? I knew the last conversation that he ever had. I knew what he laughed at. I knew that his brother had to go in and clean up after everything, and I know that they had to figure out where to throw away the mattress, where they had to throw away the, you know, it's like all these things you don't think about, because it's so easy to be like, oh, wow, that sucks, man. We sure got to take care of the veterans. Anyways, next, instead of like, no, I'm going to keep running into this guy's brother. I'm going to see him. We talk. Like, it's just the real things that are fascinating to me, that I care about, that affect me. So reading about history, reading about, and getting those little nuggets of like, oh shit, that really happened? Oh my gosh. Like, that's what I want to focus on. You know, I want to focus on, you know, Jeffrey Dahmer. Like, I, there's so many things about serial killers out there, but like, what aspect interests me? You know, okay, John Wayne Gacy, got this, that actually had him as the birthday clown. what are those guys doing right now? You know, and you have people reaching out and saying, yeah, I, you know, PTK was my next door neighbor. It's like, shit, tell me more. You know, like, it's just kind of the real world stuff instead of the gossip, the quick one-liner that everybody knows. Like, what's the real visible stuff?
Well, I like the idea of when you start showing a lot more about serial killers and these stories, because technically it's like a, like your work also reflects on the mind and ideas, kind of like if you've ever heard of an artist called Nothing Happened Today. He takes a bunch of he does illustrative work almost like kids illustrations in a way, but he takes cartoon characters and people, and he makes a lot of really funny adaptations of how, you know, a movie like he shows the monster from Pan's Labyrinth, you know, with the eyes and the hand, and
from what is it?
Pan's Labyrinth.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Guillermo del Toro's movie, and he shows him with the eyes up to the head, but he's riding a bike going downhill. You know what I mean? Like, kind of, okay, you know, funny things like that. But you know, yours reminds me of his, because he's telling like an observational point of something that he sees, right, and like how it would work in the real world. Versus, like you said, I think the craziest thing you can always come across, especially as artists or as people, is learning something that you never genuinely thought about. You know, and you're right. There is an innocence that a lot of people are born with, and you lose it at one point or another. And it's not to come off as macabre, or it's not to come off as like, oh, my life is, you know, trash. But but it's more or less of like, this is a story. This actually happened. Because I mean, it's surprising how many people literally, like when you go to Europe and you talk to people and they're like, where are you from? California. Oh, Hollywood, huh? Hollywood. They assume Hollywood is just the entire state of California. And you're like, all right, that's cool.
Right,
you
know, yeah.
San Francisco and LA in their mind is like an hour apart. Vice versa, you know, you have, you have people that are from America that are like, oh man, you know, the French, it's got to be amazing. They all drink wine and sit around the Eiffel Tower. And you realize the Eiffel Tower is like
it's
a tiny little thing. So opening up that spectrum of not only the mind, but artistically bringing in that story is great. And I saw a lot of questions on your page regarding to, like, you know, who's your favorite serial killer? Why did you choose these people? What made you, like, you did the Charlie Manson piece. You know, was there any specific reason why you chose him?
Right, yeah. And I think sometimes, like, I think about an idea and I just do it. And I don't really think too much about it. Like, oh my gosh, that's fascinating to me. I'm just going to do it and not even think about it.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I think some people just assume, like, okay, he's really passionate about this, or he loves serial killers, or, you know, but, and sometimes it's true, sometimes it isn't. A lot of times it's almost like a compulsion, like, just get it out. You know, like the comic book character stuff, done, get it out. I don't even think about it anymore. You know, some people are like, oh, you love that series. Like, oh, not really. I don't even think about it. So it is just kind of like, just take it. I remember reading about a study about two groups of people, and it was like a college class somewhere. I don't remember when. And they split the class in two, and they said, one class is just going to do quantity, tons of paintings. Just kick out as much as you can, one a day. The other class, we're just going to do one masterpiece, and that's it. Spend your whole time on one masterpiece. And so at the end of the semester or year, however long it was, the quantity people, they're like, there's like 10 things here I love. I can't believe I did these. I never would have thought about it. And like, nobody in the masterpiece class did anything of note. None of them liked any of it. Because they were thinking too much. They were too much in the moment. They were too, kind of what we were talking about earlier, too calculated. Like, I'm going to do a masterpiece. I'm going to have a guy standing looking to the left, slightly to the right. He's going to have light coming down from the top. Well, and it's just, it doesn't work. But other people are just kicking out a bunch of stuff, like taking chances, because there's nothing to lose. There's no, just do it, instead of, you know, when you're doing a masterpiece, there's everything to lose. So a lot of the thing about that of like just volume and have it related somewhat to things I'm reading about or interested or thinking of, but I don't necessarily like, it's not necessarily that thing about it that I love. Like, it's not that Mickey Mouse was the thing. It was what's underneath cartoon characters. Like, what would happen if Sesame Street had mange? Like, what do those guys look like under that? If they were real characters, what would it look like? You know, like, some of it's just kind of silliness, you know. I don't know. It's a little all over the map, but mostly just keep producing stuff that you want to see.
Right. Now, when you were doing, like, when you were doing the serial killer pieces, or when you were doing, like, even the Michael Jackson piece, which was very nice, the Dakota Pipeline piece, is that kind of like when you're doing something like, as far as like the Dakota Pipeline piece, obviously it's relevant to what's going on and how you feel about it. Now, when you're doing something like the Charles Manson piece or anything of that nature, is it something that you're reading currently at the time that inspires you to do it, or is it just something that kind of comes across your mind and you're like, you know what, I'm just going to paint and go for it?
You know, it's a little of both. A lot of these stories are things that I've been interested in forever. And if something comes up where it's like, oh, hey, it's, you know, I've been fascinated with Native American culture for forever. And, oh, now people are talking about it because of the Dakota Pipeline. Well, I'm going to come at it from this end. That they're not happy about it, but I know for a fact that they're really improving their education, you know, like their life situation, you know, to think pity party, whatever, they're, you know, that's a whole different conversation. But what I do know that if you bully somebody long enough, bad things happen.
Oh yeah.
People commit suicide over it just to leave it alone. And I don't know when I think of that Cleveland Indians logo, it's like, that is super rude. That's like having a team with blackface as the logo. Mm-hmm. You would not have that. It's the exact same type of drawing. It's a overly
embellished,
graphic. Yeah, super racist. You know, the red skin, the hook nose, and you know these. It's like, and people won't fight for that one. They're just gonna let that keep going. All right, like the Dakota Pipeline, I get it, but I promise you that you're not gonna stop a bunch of white guys from getting oil. So that's a battle. Like, okay, cool. It sucks, but you've lost that one. What about this other one? What about global like respect for these people and starting off with like not having stuff like that? But you know, and people get pissed, whatever.
Oh yeah, I think. But it's just, I think that's very hard for a lot of artists though, because, I mean, I'm speaking from my own point of view, but I'm also representing you know, World of Pencils and so forth, but. Not coming from World of Pencils, but coming from myself. I genuinely do think that it is harder in today's age to have an opinion about something, even as artists, because artists usually tend to use their art to express themselves, or you know, to bring light to something that's on their radar. But someone's always had something to say about it. I mean, if you look at other like podcasts, like Joe Rogan's podcast, he said it himself. He goes, "We're in a response culture, you know. We're in a society now where people automatically have to respond to something, even if you're just giving an opinion. They feel like they have to give theirs back." And I get exactly what you're saying when it comes to the painting. And I applaud you for it, man. There's a lot of artists I know that will never, ever truly paint what they want to paint because they're afraid of the backlash that they'll get from people that just want to complain. There are people, of course, that firmly believe in what they believe, either side. You know, that's their way of thinking, and, you know, nothing against that. but there are people that are just looking to troll and looking to cause havoc and mayhem.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, so I commend you for that, man. That's a great thing.
Yeah, the world of professionally offended people is destroying the creativity of others, because there's so many things that, I mean, think of all the conversations people have and like just cussing and horrible jokes, you know, when they're with their friends. But when they're in the setting of like, I think I should be offended by this, they get all super like, can I talk to your manager type stuff? Like,
yeah,
about these dumb things. It's like, you don't care about this.
Yeah.
The Michael Jackson one was a real big eye opener, because within that, with the other stuff, I tried to have a little bit of a story, like the Kim Kardashian, OJ Simpson one, where it's like, okay, here's the connection here. And even then people were like, whatever, you know, but the Michael Jackson one was very interesting. A lot of people got super offended by that. And it's interesting because I didn't do anything that he didn't do.
Right.
Like, I just compared a photo of him in the 70s and a photo of him like in the 2000s. And, you know, and the fact that I just always found it interesting that he really fought the idea that I don't have plastic surgery. Like, nope. Like, really?
Like a form of dysmorphia. Like a form of dysmorphia.
Yeah. 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 Oh, absolutely. And I just thought, okay, let's just see what that looks like. If we're going to line his face up, both faces, let's just see how off they ended up being. Mm. And so many people read so many things into it. And I think, I mean, his skin was very light by the end, because of vitiligo, or claims of vitiligo, and putting right. makeup on to cover it, which is fine. If that's true, I would never poke fun at it. And even if he wanted to look that way, I'm not really poking fun at it. It was just like, here's the difference.
Yeah, it's an observation.
I think it's not
a critique.
Yeah, and I think people get so excited to fight something where, like, their first thought is, "This looks racist," mm-hmm. and they jump on it. I remember I did one. I can't remember which one it was, and it wasn't on my account. Somebody else posted it. I think it was the Bill Cosby and the Stanford rapist case.
Oh.
And somebody wrote, "This is blackfacing. I'm calling the cops." Like, and what it was like this little pissant 16-year-old kid, you know, or no, he says, I'm reporting this and calling the cops. This is illegal. Like, what? Like, that, first of all, that is not what blackface is.
Yeah.
That is not blackfacing. And that, you know, it was just like, people just get all like, oh my God, I'm going to be the whistleblower in this one. I'll be the guy that shut this artist down for doing, you know, like, and they don't even focus on like, okay, well, what was he trying to do there? And I had people, like, no lie, saying, you know, you made fun of Michael Jackson. I hope you go to hell and you're raped every day in your fucking ass. And I'm like, really?
And that's ignorant. You know, like, and you're right. Like, it's interesting to see what people are trying to just get upset about these days. I mean, anything today is considered a very temperamental thing to talk about or so forth. But, like, you're right. Everyone has their own interpretation of your artwork. I'm looking at the Michael Jackson one right now, and you want to know what I see? Like, legitimately, no joke aside, when I first saw it, was I saw Mr. Terrific, who is a black superhero in the DC universe. I was like, huh, wow. I kind of get it.
Nice.
I was like, I kind of get it. But I also see what you're saying. But that's because I'm a fucking nerd. Like,
yeah.
I looked at it and I was like, all right, comic books. You know.
The fascinating thing with that one, I thought, he's had a horrible life. I've read about it.
Yeah.
Michael Jackson came by his crazy, honestly, if he was. Mm-hmm. And I'm certainly not poking fun at that whatsoever. But in addition to, like, the difference between the photos is how happy he was as a kid and how just frightened and empty he was as an adult. Mm-hmm. Even comparing music and stuff, like, he'd lost all his flavor. I think we just beat it out of him like Elvis, where it was just like, we're taking everything you've ever got, man. Everything you have is ours now.
Yeah.
Like, we all own Michael Jackson. We all own Elvis. And so just fascinating to see, like, here's this kind of happy young African-American boy. And then you kind of see the old scared ghost of Michael Jackson at the end. It's like, God, that's sad and that's scary. Like, that's what we did to this guy. And that's what his dad did to him. That's what his brothers did to him. Like, the guy largely had a horrible life, minus some fame and money. Everything else is pretty rotten, it sounds like.
Well, the thing to learn from that as well, even as artists, is that there is a demand for something. You know, being like, yeah, observing things as a musician, as I have over the past almost, what, 30 years, and then now as an artist in the physical realm of painting and sketching, you know, the crazy thing that I'm sure you're going through now is, you know, people don't realize that there is a demand that people expect.
Yeah.
You know, there's an expectation and demand that people expect from an artist without considering this person being a real person. And the caveat is, well, you're right, getting paid. Well, you're famous, or you're this, you're that. And so therefore, when something isn't as good as it used to be, or they latch onto some old idea of an older form of art, whether it be music or a painting or a drawing, and it's not the same qualities, because the person may not be in the same point of their life or the same mindset. And then all of a sudden they're like, well, you suck, you don't know what you're doing. Like, all of a sudden it's kind of like sports for me. You know, my family are huge in the sports. I'm really not so much, but you know, I'll sit down and watch a game. I'm a bit of a hockey enthusiast, but like, the funniest thing and the way to think about it in my head is, you see somebody yelling and screaming at the top of their lungs, "You son of a gun, God damn it, you can't even run 15 yards. And yet the person that's yelling this is 300 pounds and could not even take 10 yards, you know, at like a quarter of their pace.
Right.
And it's like, I'm right and you're wrong because I bought these tickets. And I've seen that.
Right.
I've seen
exactly.
I've seen that translate artistically with you, because I've seen your stuff shared on BuzzFeed. I've seen it shared on, like, I was on Facebook, God, had to have been like 4 months ago, and somebody had posted a video of your work and was like, there's this artist who's doing these crazy paintings, but wait, there's more. You know, typical stuff where it's like they treat you like you're a 6-year-old who's, you know, retarded. And if anyone gets mad because I'm using that word, I don't care. I'm sorry. But the idea of, like, they treat you like you're dumb. And it's just like, there's a beautiful picture of, you know, Jack Nicholson. But wait a minute, there's another Jack Nicholson. Fooled you, didn't we?
Right, yeah.
Bamboozled.
And, right.
And I remember looking at it and I was like, wow, he's getting pretty big. Like, this is obviously before we had ever spoken with each other. But I was like, wow, that's good for him. Like, I genuinely was happy to see your work being pushed
on
a large platform. But the only thing I was like, God damn it, don't do it. Don't do the one thing you know that you're not going to do. You're having a good day. Read Facebook comments. And of course, I was like, you know what? I love his work. I want to, all I need to do is see somebody saying that he's doing good work and it'll be fine. Like, I'm walking into a burning building expecting not to get burned. You know what I mean? Stupid of me.
Right, right, right.
And you read the comments and there are people who are like, you know, all the way from this typical, like, why would somebody want this in their house? All the way down to, like, is this where you want to be when Jesus comes back, Ricky Bobby? And so, you know, it's interesting to see it. But then there were people that were, you know, like, oh, you know, this is Blake Neubert from Instagram and you follow his stuff and it's beautiful. It's this. And somebody had asked a question that ties into the whole, like, that what you were saying about how Michael Jackson's life was the artist expectations now to your art. Now that you're getting so much more exposure over, especially over the past year, it's grown exponentially. Do you feel that there is a pressure to maintain what you're doing now? Not to say that because you're trying to cater to everybody, but everyone has kind of found your art as the scrape painter or as the, you know,
right,
macabre painter.
Yeah.
And as that grows, right, that kind of puts you into, like, this is your thriller right now. This is your little box. And you're trying to, venture out. I'm expecting you to do a self-portrait with a white tiger, please. That's going to be your thriller. But
the doggone girl is mine will be my hit.
I used to know that boy.
Seriously,
I used to know that boy before he got famous. He was a great boy. Jesus.
you know, like, so here, that's a conscious effort of what I've been doing lately. Mm-hmm. The scrapes are fun. They are, act as a vehicle for telling a really quick story. Like, here's this. Oh, but here's also this. And you could make that so cheesy. You could be like, here's a cocoon, scrape, butterfly. And like, that's it. And I know the direction of that can go horrible. And so my thought was, I'm going to just do sincere things with that. And then if people like it, if they don't, whatever. But I'm not going to turn into a gimmick because it already is a gimmick. But I'm going to use it as just a quick vehicle to tell a story. So I think I've stopped doing that. It's kind of the Bob Dylan thing. If you track Bob Dylan's career, every direction, when he started getting famous, he would then go the other way. Mm-hmm. Folk music, and then he plugs in, plays electric. That does really well. I'm going to do Nashville skyline country music. And then I'm going to do the, you know, like all of a sudden it's like wherever you like, I'm going to go here. So unless I've got a really strong idea that I need to tell in a scrape way, I'm not going to do it. Like that, I'm not just going to be that stuff because it's going to get old, going to get cheesy, and I don't want to force anything to where I am doing stuff where it's like, here's a young guy and here's an old guy. You know, like, wow. I'm not going to do that. Like, if the second it becomes something that's just a gimmick, 100%, mm-hmm. I'm done. I'm not going to do it. So that's why I pull back, and I don't do that many right now because if it's not what I want to do, I'm not going to do it. You know, right now I want to do these other paintings that I'm working on that I think are as good, if not better than those. Because those technically, the scrape paintings aren't good paintings. They're not technically like, I mean, they're fast. When I paint, I don't have that much time in a week to paint. I maybe have 8 to 10 hours a week that I can paint. So I got to just kick this stuff out really fast. So with the scrape boy stuff, like, I'm not going to do it all the time because that's what people expect. Even though they want it. If I do it all the time, they'll be like, man, this guy sucks. I'm sick of seeing this shit. You know, like, people don't know when to tell you, you know, they want everything until they're bored with it.
Yeah.
And I get that. I'm the same way. If someone's posting the same stuff, it's like, man, show me more, more, more. Okay. That was way too many. Now I'm sick of it. I'm unfollowing you.
Yeah, you're gonna be.
You know what I mean? Like, it's just
reading,
weird.
You're gonna be reading the comments. You're like, this shit sucks. Wish I never followed you at Brushes of Doom. You're all that fat son of a bitch.
Right. Yeah.
No, I.
Well, and here's a weird thing. Mm-hmm. Oh.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
You go.
No, you said something weird. I want to hear weird. Come on.
Tell me. Oh, I was gonna say, like, so reading comments. I don't do that anymore. Sometimes I do, but not really. Years ago, I made a video. Do you remember that guy that did the Morgan Freeman iPad drawing with his finger?
Oh, yeah. I remember that one.
Okay. And it got really famous, like the 20 million. It was kind of like one of the very first, like, viral process videos of, like, here's this. And so I saw the gimmick in it. I saw the trick. I saw how he did it. Like, sure, it took a lot of time, and he spent a lot of craft into it, but I think he just reverse engineered a photo, did like a color sample, and just like blah 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 reverse engineered the thing. So I made a video of that and posted, because a buddy of mine didn't believe it. I said, dude, I know how he did it, I'll show you. And so I then post the video that night, and I have, this is like 10 years ago now or whenever this was, I had no followers, no nothing. I mean, I had no even YouTube videos. And so I post it and I go to sleep. And then the next morning I wake up and it's got 56,000 views in just a few hours, which for me was like, what just happened? Like, I mean, I didn't even spell check the thing. There was grammar. I mean, it was just like, here, buddy, I'll show you how to do it. I made a video. Didn't think anybody would watch it. And so I started getting all these really mean comments from people that, like, why would you care what I'm doing? Like, they just wanted to fight. And that was my first experience of, like, the average dipshit. Yeah, you know, like, all of a sudden they're really passionate about iPad drawings or whatever, you know, like, you don't care about this. What, you just want to fight.
Yeah.
And then so jump back. I mean, actually, I shut the video down because I just felt like super violated. I was like, God, I don't want anybody to see this. Like, I wasn't ready to show people, mm-hmm. you know, spelling errors. And ultimately, I didn't own the rights to that photo. Mm-hmm. So I took it down. So jump ahead a few years to when I think it was Business Insider first posted a kind of a compilation video of like five or six of the paintings that I did. And so when you do art in your life, you start off and people are like super supportive, right? Mm-hmm. Your family is like, oh, this is our son. He's the artsy one. And then you have your buddies and they're like, yeah, my buddy Blake, he can draw anything. You go to college, you high school, you know, people are supportive. You have people that challenge you and say, why are you doing this? You know, like teachers and whatnot. But largely people are supportive of your direction. Then you start an online profile of here's my work. And then you typically attract people that like the same kind of stuff, especially with art. You know, like you like portraits. So do I. Come look at my stuff. Cool. I'll follow you. You know, like, but it's not until if you have the opportunity or the luxury or the misery of having your stuff shared to just anybody, like I didn't realize what was happening. Actually, I was I had a part-time job at the time. I was working at a retail place and I looked down and my phone is just blowing up like crazy. And I'm like, what's happening? And a buddy of mine's like, dude, the internet's blowing up. I'm like, why? What happened? He's like, check out this video. And it was up to like 1.5 million views, 10,000 comments, 100,000 shares. And I'm like, holy crap. Like I ran into the bathroom because I was like, oh my God, what's happening? Like I just got these flashbacks from all these people, you know, yelling at me for this Morgan iPhone. I was like, oh my God, this is going to be so bad.
The top comment was, I still remember the Morgan Freeman. Yeah. Don't think I forgot, yeah. Rich boy. You can hide in but the bathroom, but I mean, bathroom, in my mind, I'm like,
oh my. Yeah, I see you. There's cameras in there. And so I'm like, shit, I got to read these comments. So I'm like hiding in the bathroom, going through my phone, and to my. You know, happiness, I guess, like 95% is favorable. Like, whoa, awesome, cool. You know, like one-liners, like, oh, shoot, thank God. And then you get someone that's like, this is so fucking stupid. This shit is lame. I was doing this shit in high school. I was blah, blah, blah. And then I'm like, oh, my God. And then I look at their page, and it's like, oh, my God, you're the worst fucking artist on the planet, and your vote counts as much as anybody else's on these comments. And so it was just such a weird thing. Like someone could just shit all over me and I couldn't do, you know, I didn't want to like fight with them about it, but I was like, God, but at the same time, it was this really interesting, exciting thing of like, finally I'm getting to see what someone honestly thinks about something. Mm-hmm. 'Cause you got your art buddies where you're like, what do you think? And they're like, yeah, bro. Cool, dude. And in their mind, they're like, dude, this shit is so stupid.
Yeah.
And you never hear that. And I've always kind of craved to hear that. So, well, it was this really bizarre experience to hear people just shit all over my, you know, where it's like, this guy's sick and twisted. If there's ever any murders in Colorado, you know who to find.
Yeah.
Or why would you waste your talent on this? And, you know, like,
this where you want to be when Jesus comes back. Yeah. I think we're reading the same comments.
And so, right. Yeah, yeah. And so I think it's this whole thing of really seeing what people think. But at the same time, I look at it too. It's like, sure, to somebody, it totally looks like a waste of the talent. Like, you just scraped up all the good parts. Like, well, you know, I can do it again, guys. Don't worry.
Yeah.
You know, like, if you can do it once, you can do it again. And I never really ever thought people would care about that part of it. I actually never even thought anybody would give a shit about the process at all. It was almost initially, I was making videos to track how many views, because I actually thought my wife was buying me followers because I'd been so massively unpopular for so long and was so sad about it. And I started doing my weird paintings and I just couldn't believe they were getting more popular. And I thought, there's no way. You know, I went from like 1,700 to 15,000 in like 3 or 4 months.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what? How is this happening? Like, somebody's buying me followers. And then the video function either became more prevalent or I just happened to notice it more. And I saw, oh, you can actually see how many people actually would look at your profile. Maybe if I've got 15,000 followers and like 8 people watch my video, then I'll know.
Yeah.
And so I posted just some kind of cheesy stuff I used to work on when I was younger as a kid. You know, these kind of double images where you draw on one side and then flip it over on the other and hold it up to the light and you can see both sides. And I thought, well, I'll do something like that. And then it just became this thing where people were like, whoa, that's so cool. Like, how, you know, and I never even thought people would care about the how. Mm-hmm. And then jumped to the, I happened to do this one where I was like, oh, I know what I'm going to do. And then I do the scrape one. It was like a 20-minute painting. It's like 2 a.m. I am so tired. I've got a big day of work tomorrow. And I thought, I'm just going to do this thing real quick, film it, and then we're good. And then I post it on my lunch break. I come back. My phone is almost dead from batteries because my screen is lit up so much from people commenting. And I'm like, what the – how did this happen? Like, people – like, it kind of blew up. And then I started – then the next one I did completely horrible. And I thought, okay, that was just a one-shot gimmick. That's fine. And then I thought, well, I don't know. I think there's something I could do with this. So I started just kind of pushing through it, where the old me would have been like, oh, God, just delete the old one too. Like, this didn't work. This was so cheesy. But I thought, you know what? I could tell a quick story with this method, you know. Mm-hmm. And so I started doing, you know, I probably have 20 or so. And I just powered through it, and they started getting more and more popular. So if I would have quit when I thought my gut was telling me, just quit, dude, nobody likes it anymore. And the one that tanked is one of the most popular ones now. It's the blonde with the ball gag.
Yeah.
When I first posted that, I got no interest on that. And so I was really embarrassed by it and wanted to delete it. But I thought, no, I still stand by it. That's a solid image. And so, yeah, I just kind of powering through it and kind of sticking to your guns and realizing that most of my hipster art peers are going to think this is cheesy or, you know, it's definitely not accepted by some. I could see a lot of people writing it off as gimmicky and cheesy, but I don't give a shit about that. Like, I don't care what people think about it. Where that's a huge departure to where I used to be, where I kind of look around and like, gosh, which of these cool art guys are following me? They're not following me. I wonder why. Like, I don't give a shit. I'm not following them either.
Yeah.
You know, like, whatever. I'm not going to do this stuff for anybody else. And so that's kind of the whole purpose of that stuff, is like, if I want to tell a story, I'll do it. But I also have to realize that, yeah, people are going to shit all over it, and I have to be okay with that. Either they're going to think it's cheesy, stupid, offensive, whatever. Like, sure, it's all those things. Anyways, I'm going to do another one now.
I
you just got to roll with it because – oh, go ahead.
Oh, no. You're completely right. And I completely agree with you, because a long time ago, not in a galaxy far, far away, but in a very small tattoo shop, did I ever learn from when Instagram was still kind of fairly new, one of my buddies ended up showing me. He goes, hey, man, I know how to get a crazy amount of followers really quick, and you don't have to pay for them. And I was like, all right, cool. Like, what do you do? And he's like, you got a hashtag. And he had these 3 lists of like 30 hashtags, and he goes, check this out. And he posted them on his photo, and he got like 200 followers. I'm looking at this, like, go on. And then he deletes the comment, and he reposts the second one with all the hashtags, and it goes up another 80 followers. I mean, it was just nonstop to the point where he had all these followers. And, He must have reached like about 150,000, and it was just him sitting in a chair, you know, doing this over and over and over off of different pictures. And wow. One of the artists at the shop is a very well respected tattoo artist, and he was sitting down. He's an older cat, and he was looking at it. And I go, "Why don't you do that, man?" You know, just out of curiosity. And he goes, "You know, I'll show you something." And he posted a photo, and it immediately got like about 100 likes on what he had posted. But he went through every single person that had liked it, and it was peers, you know, people that he loved their work or respected and so forth. And he says, you know, man, it's
right.
It's not always the amount of people that like something, it's the people who like it, because there is quality in behind right. it, you know? Because after a certain yeah. point, if you're just doing it for the amount of something, then you're never truly doing it for the purpose that it's meant to be done. And I was like, wow, that's right, that, that's right. like a very prolific thing. And then
it is.
And I go, well, you know, do you feel that you are always trying to compete with the people that like it? You know, take in mind, if you like, let's just say Chaz Bohorquez, or if we are looking at Sean Cheatham, you know, in your example, you know, I had mentioned some people to him. I go, what are you trying to impress them? And he goes, oh, no, man. He goes, I can give two shits about what those fools think. He goes, but we're good enough friends that they are honest. He goes, they're honest enough with me to know that I'm a peer. I'm somebody that can, if I sat down at a paint night with them, we could equally hold our own and inspire each other.
Right, right.
Not jerk each other off because right. one has more than the other. So I completely agree with you. Right. Man. Let's cover this real quick. I know that we're getting up to the 2 hour mark, which is awesome. I mean, dude, talking to you has been fun. Definitely funny.
Oh, too. Absolutely. It's great.
yes. You're at a cafe right now, aren't you?
Restaurant.
Yeah. Oh man, I don't mind him. You're just sitting in the corner staring at everybody on your phone. By the way, I used to yeah. I used
just
to know
some weird
Deadpool
guy
was.
Talking to his phone, laughing.
Yeah. Look at that boy, Mariam. Look at him, hooligan. Okay, if there's a murder around here, you know it's gonna be him. Oh, good. What do you use, or what are your preferred, for anyone that is curious, tools of the trade, your weapons of doom, so to speak, to paint and sketch? What oil paints are you into? Acrylics, anything?
You know what's funny is I have some of the best. I've got Old Holland paint. I got Rosemary and Company and Roy and Langnickel brushes, Source Tech canvases, I mean, Clausens and all this stuff. And I don't ever use it because I'm afraid to ruin it. I know that's a pretty common art thing where, like, I've got a brush that's $150 and I would not dare get paint on it. Like, God, this thing is beautiful. Like, it just holds in my hand so well, and the bristles are perfect. Like, I'm not putting paint on this thing. This thing's perfect. So that's kind of a joke I teach. You know, like, for me, supplies have to be expendable.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning, like, I'm not going to feel bad. You know, the stuff that I use is some of the lowest quality stuff you can buy while it's still being called technically art supplies. I will literally go and buy brushes from Walmart, paint from Walmart. I mean, acrylic, you know, across the board pretty much for me. I mean, I can tell the difference between some gold. I mean, gold for sure is different, but again, I don't want to waste that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I just buy super cheap stuff, Winton oil paints or Winsor Newton. I mean, Winsor Newton's nice. I love that stuff. So that's about as much as I splurge and actually use as Winsor Newton. Some Rembrandts. But really, I just buy these kind of cheap little paint brush kits, like Royland Langnickel paintbrushing kits that are probably meant for, you know, hobbyist paintings of like, I'm going to paint these Civil War action figurine guys or whatever. So, yeah, I love just being kind of reckless with it. You know, my supplies are they work for me. I don't work for them. Meaning I just do whatever I want. Like if I squirt out, you know, tons of paint because I don't even care. It's super cheap. Whereas if it's, you know, Old Holland, like I'm just going to do just a tiny dot and I don't want to waste this because that's cad red and that's the most valuable stuff on the planet. Thank God cars don't run on cad red. I don't use that stuff. And then there's some artist that said, paint like you're a millionaire, meaning use your paint. A lot of people's biggest painting mistakes is they're not using enough paint. They're not fully going out there. Like my paintings are pretty buttery. They're thick because I love that look. I love really just getting the color on there and not being miserly with it. So really kind of cheap stuff up until a point. Then it's Winsor Newton. And then I think Monarch brushes. I can't remember who does Monarch. But Rosemary and Company are probably my favorites. If I was to use them on a painting, they feel different than other companies.
Nice. Is there any specific like bristle that you see? I mean, well, let me back up. You use acrylic primarily, or is it a mixture between acrylic and oil? Because a lot of your stuff for the Alla Prima, it has that oil look and feel to it, but other like I see you painting and it looks like acrylic as well.
It really depends. Sometimes it is both. I should probably say more what it is, just depending on the painting. Like Ted from Accounting, that one, the recent one of the guy that's hanging himself, that's oil. Things that look more muted and that buttery look is oil. Things that are kind of sharp and bright colors is acrylic. Just because, you know, oils, I can't find stuff that can mimic what acrylics can do with some of those bright colors. So it just depends. It depends how quickly, because sometimes it's like I have 1 hour to kick something out and I'm not going to use, maybe I do use oil. Maybe if it's something I know oil can do, I'll do it. But if it's something like, okay, I need to have 3 layers of this quick, I'm going to do acrylic because it needs to dry. I can't have any time to wait. So yeah, it's kind of functional. Whatever I got around me, whatever I'm willing to use a lot of and not be too precious with.
And as far as brushes, is there a specific type of bristle or shape you go for, like filberts, cat's tongues, rounds?
Egberts and filberts are pretty cool. I like a long bristle to them. I don't like brights. I don't like rounds, really. Unless it's for little details, but I always like to have a bigger brush than what I need so I don't get caught up in tiny details. And again, speed is my main function in life as far as like, okay, I got to cover this background quick, so I use really big brushes. And seeing Ben Durkin work, the dude uses huge brushes, and you can just get way more kind of inspiring problem solving when you use a huge brush. You can't use detail to bail yourself out. You got to say, okay, I'm going to do this nose in like 3 swipes. So here we go.
Nice. Let's see. We're good on time. Yes, we are good on time. Lastly, if you have any specific colors that you like working with.
Yeah, let's see. Viridian is the green that I use.
Viridian?
I love that for anything. Viridian, yep. I think the Rembrandt and Viridian's pretty solid color. I mean, Winsor Newton's pretty good too, for sure. Cobalt blue. If I'm using a lot of something, I'll go to ultramarine blue because it's a cheaper color by a little bit. Cerulean's a good color, but that's more expensive, so I don't try to use that one as much. Rembrandt or Winsor Newton. Permanent mauve is a good color. Purples are hard. I like kind of any purple, but their light fastness isn't as reliable. Let's see, what else do I use?
A lot of love.
Burnt sienna. Gotta have that one. Either raw sienna or yellow ochre, depending what I got in front of me. They're about the same in my opinion, or from what I use them for. They're different colors, but those are the mainly it. I use a pretty limited palette. Every once in a while I'll pull a transparent oxide red and replace that for the burnt sienna. I'll throw in an Indian yellow from time to time. It's not a great mixing color, but I'll use it. But that's mostly it. I try not to have a very broad palette just because I try to have them as functional as possible, meaning, okay, I know exactly what these two colors mix to give me this color.
Right.
So if I start all of a sudden throwing an olive green, it's like, oh, shit, what does this color do? I don't know what it does when you mix with this. And it may be a great color. I'm just, again, speed is everything. So I know what cobalt blue and burnt sienna look like in all the shades. So it's like, okay, I know what function these do. If I add a little permanent mob to that, okay, perfect. I know what that's going to do. if I'm doing a landscape, I'll throw in oxide of chromium because that's a designer color, in my opinion, where it's like, shit, straight out of the tube, man. You got trees. But, yeah, Terra Rosa is another one that's kind of an easy designer color where out of the tube you've got some pretty good stuff to work with. But, yeah, pretty limited. I don't use any cad orange or cad yellow. They're just too powerful, and I just don't really have the palette for them. They don't do much for me.
Your palette is very warm, but it doesn't have an intense, I wouldn't want to say heat to it, but like what cadmium yellow would add, or like a canary yellow, stuff like that. Even like really harsh oranges, I don't see a lot of that in your palette. Everything's almost kind of like a muted tone, but definitely on the warmer side, which is why I think, like you're saying, your palette has to correspond with other colors. It has to be able to work together in order to create like a harmony.
Yeah. It's like, you know, if you look at the different palettes you can use, the Zorn palette or what Mike Husser used to teach everybody, they're all in like the same key and they all work together. Mm-hmm. So if you're, you know, you just do your research and say, okay, these colors work together well. So mine's, I don't even know, mine's just probably like, if it was a guitar, it's probably standard E tuning. There's nothing too fancy about it, but they all have a function that,
go
you
with
know,
each other.
Cad red. I do have a cad red in there. I use that very, limited, but that is my red that I use.
You splurger, you.
I know. Don't tell anybody, dude.
Ah, no, dude, it's not like we've been recording for 2 hours. Not at all. Don't worry about it. Shh, our secret. Yeah, I definitely genuinely think that people would get a kick out of knowing what you do, because that's the number one thing. People always assume that if I just know his paints, if I know just the brush, then I'll be able to do that. It's like you could practically do this with almost anything in your arsenal. You just have to sit down and do it, you know. But knowing the tones and the palettes, like a Zorn palette, you know, for anyone that knows what a Zorn palette is out there, knowing that helps you kind of achieve that look, rather than blatantly going in and being like, oh, a cadmium red with a ochre yellow, and trying to get it to be like a cadmium yellow. It's not going to work. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah. And you know, there is something to be said for people thinking, if I just had those Air Jordans, I could dunk. I remember talking to, I never used to ask artists, what colors do you use? Cause they're not going to give a shit and answer that question. And, you know, just buy their video if you really are concerned. But I remember asking, Bjorklund, who's like, what colors? Like, that's what it is. You're using these colors and these brushes. And then you see, it's like, oh, and he uses a lot of colors and big brushes, and there's definitely something to it. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, he's just a phenomenal painter.
Yeah.
Like King's Blue, that's the color he uses for those highlights. Good luck making it look like his. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
that's his thing. Like, that's, you can't, you know, I thought, okay, that's, you know, or when you see Jeremy Lipking's, probably more 10 years ago, like a lot of the interior bedroom scenes, you'd have that really beautiful cerulean blue, kind of green, kind of gray. And you think, okay, what's the color for that? Because that's what I'm going to make. And that's going to make me a great painter.
Yeah.
And you find out, okay, that's probably, you know, olive green plus cerulean blue and magic. Don't add magic, because that's how you get that look.
Yeah. Well, it's a tone. It's something that you're looking at and you're attracted to. It's like you know, like in music, some people like stuff written in a minor key or in a diminished key or in a major. So it's like, oh, I like this to sound really happy. So anything does not matter the band, does not matter the era. If it sounds relatively that close to that, they are attracted to it.
Now, right.
Like with art, like you're saying, if you look at something and it has a palette or a tone, if it's cool or warm, you know, is it a complementive colors? Are they analog colors? Whatever it may be, you automatically like what you like. And if you if you're thinking that's what's, you know, if I just master that gray or if I master that tone, I'll be the best ever. Well, you can know how to make it 1,000 ways a Sunday, but do you know how to apply it? You know, like you said,
lip right, exactly.
And Björklund are all very well versed in what they do, but they know how to apply that. They know how to
exactly
take it a specific way.
Right. Yep.
We are at pretty much the end of this, my friend. So let's take some questions that you got. You've actually gotten quite a few awesome questions. So you want to do a speed round?
Oh man, there were some doozies. Speed round, man. Let's rattle off as many as we can.
Yeah, no, definitely. We got about a good 10 minutes, 15 minutes. So answer to whatever you like, man. So let's see. We'll name out some people here. We have Zim. Autistic X2, I believe that's the name. What's your favorite piece of someone else's work? Do you have a specific piece of work?
Let's see. There's a kid crying in this restaurant right now, so hopefully everybody gets that.
I can't hear it.
Okay, perfect. Good. gosh, I don't know. I think there's a Klimt painting. I think it's called Judith. I know, I mean, I can see it in my head, but that one's incredible. And Björklund hardly ever titles stuff, or if he does, they're not on his page much. But any of the half faces in water blow me away. It's called Hold No Guns, but it's a woman with red hair and a red coat, and she's standing in front of a refrigerator. Mm-hmm. That one blows me away. So those would probably be top of the list.
Nice. Dreddy Crocker. Which serial killer intrigues you the most?
There's something about Jeffrey Dahmer that fascinates me because he has a level of empathy and sympathy and human. Like if you watch some of his last interviews, there's something else going on. Like he knows he's done wrong. He feels bad about it. He's chemically got some shit going on. Did he do horrible things? Absolutely. Are there ramifications to that? Absolutely. Definitely not defending what he did, but he's fascinating to me. John Wayne Gacy's fascinating to me because of the double life that he led and how big of a piece of shit he really was and how he admitted to it. And then years later held this kind of pious mentality of like, well, I'm not like those other guys, those freaks, man. I never did any of that stuff. He's fascinating to me. They all are, but those probably stick out.
There it is. Benjamin Björklund, what do you think about Tommies? He's talking about the pastrami joint down south, right?
I don't know. It's in Los Angeles, and it's like the chili burgers or something.
Yeah.
We were walking around one night, and we were like hungry, and we're like, I guess we'll go to this place. And he's vegan, so he only can eat the fries. And so I'm eating this thing, and we're walking home, just like, I think we're gonna die. Like, I think this is it. Like, we and so we joke about it. We're like, God damn, Tommy, what did you do to us? So, bit of an inside joke there, but real funny.
Let's see. This one comes from Marshane. Marsha Neubert.
My mom.
Oh, there you go. Nice. Hello, mom.
There we go.
Which medium is easiest for?
Hey, mom.
Which medium is easiest for a beginner to learn and be most successful from the start?
Let's see. Good question, mom.
Mom always has.
Oil is not. I know, right? Oil is counterintuitive, I believe. Painting is counterintuitive because of how we do. And I think it's actually from like homework at school, from us using pencils all the time, like a dry mark on a dry surface. Mm-hmm. Just makes sense to us as far as mark making. And then you jump to paint and all of a sudden we've got a wide brush. It's wet. It's probably mixed with other stuff that's wet. So it's completely opposite to how our brain is built. So oil paint, I think, is the hardest. I mean, colored pencil is probably the easiest, and not the easiest. I mean, there's guys that are amazing things. but it's, it, you can jump into it and it make, it's intuitive to what we're used to. And then pastels, acrylic, watercolor, oil.
I agree with that. It's like an easy transition from familiarity to obscurity.
I think so. Yeah. And at the end of the day, a lot of art stuff's track and field. I mean, if you're good at the hurdles, you're probably good at the 500 meter dash. And, you know, I mean, like a lot of it, it's fairly transferable.
Agreed. Velia Croix or Croix. What is your favorite book written by Stephen King?
I actually don't have one. I've never read one of his books.
I just watch all the movies. I'm right there with you.
Yeah. Gosh, I don't know. You know what? Actually, wait. Didn't he write Rita Hayworth and Shawshank Redemption?
Yes. Yes, he did.
I think that's... So I'm going to say that movie and pretend I read the book.
Awesome. So we're pretending to
read... that's my favorite book.
Awesome. We're pretending to read the book, but we actually really read it. But don't worry. We won't tell anybody. And if you say anything...
Yeah. I'm a learned doctor.
I'm a learned doctor with many, many credentials. You're a curly-haired fuck hillbilly. let's see. Doggo in you, are you woke?
Sometimes a few ideas will hit me and I feel a little bit woke, but mostly not. I'm tired.
Nice. Drake, Mr. Jose Palguilian, 28, and that's a mouthful. What are the meaning/reasons for your hand tattoos?
That's a good question. A lot of people ask me that one, and I've never really addressed it. Those are actually Pennsylvania Dutch German hex symbols. That's actually something that if you were had a farm in like central Pennsylvania area, you would paint these on barns for good luck. So my family, that's kind of the homestead where everybody's from. So just a memory of where it all comes from, I suppose. But it's funny because it actually looks like the Assyrian flag. So people were like, what? Are you serious? I'm like, no. And you know, then all of a sudden a lot of people were jumping on like, this is terrorist art. You see what happens when terrorists paint? They cut people up.
I saw him on BuzzFeed. I saw him on BuzzFeed and knew that he was a terrorist.
Yeah, so, and people think my fingers say 666 on them, but they don't. If you look very closely, that's not even close to true.
They say 999.
They say 999, mark of the feast.
As a fat guy, I approve. What do your fingers say?
Those are birth dates.
Oh, okay. I won't ask.
birth dates for the people that I've murdered.
Oh, well, duh. I wasn't going to out you, but good job, jackass. Winston Smith 44, aliens, ?
Aliens. Probably something, but not like to the effect of like how Hollywood does it. But there's got to be something else. Maybe they're already here. We just don't even know to look for them. But Area 51, I think it's probably cooler than what really happened. Just, you know, all that stuff.
And just a bunch of go-karts in there. And they're like, they think we're doing real stuff in here. Rap, 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 rap. Gina O'Sharon Custom Art. Do you miss the original drawing when you scrape the second layer or miss the fact that you can't do it again?
Nope, never do. Because usually my end result is like, I want to see what this whole thing looks like together. So the top layers is blocking me from what I want to see anyways. And again, going back to I think it's Richard Schmidt. If you're good enough to do it once, you can do it twice. Yep. So I never give him like, oh man, I'll never be able to do that face again. I just have to trust that
this thing I just painted,
I should be able to do it again.
This thing I just did right. On my own. I can't do it again. You only get it once, ladies. Only once. What feeds your deepest inspirations for your art? You love J. Maz?
The truth and lies. I mean, I love the reality of things that we're hiding. That's probably the biggest thing that's fascinating to me is, and humor. I hate humor. No, I'm just kidding. and it's like the idea of being able to throw something in there, you know, like, but just kind of hide it to where it's like, is he trying to be funny or is he weird? Like both.
Look at that guy in the back. He's been sitting there for 2 hours, 5 minutes and exactly 46 seconds on a phone. I don't know if he's trying to be funny or not. Have you, Anna Rock 96, have you ever, okay, she's not, English isn't the first thing, so I'm going to reword this. Have you ever thought of doing an expose of your work in Latin America and or other places? Cheers from Colombia.
Yes. No, I try not to think too much about where things could go and all that. But yeah, I'd love to show stuff in other places, but I don't even know how to get that going.
I'm pretty sure somebody listening or down the line will definitely help out, man. If you ever do, contact Racing Gallery. When we get off, I'll tell you there are awesome people out in New York and they know a lot of cool people too. So see if we can get you to Colombia. Nice.
Sweet.
Carls.Martin. What's your actual inspiration? Do you think before you're going to draw or do you just act in the moment? That's a good question.
I think before, definitely, like it's pretty well sketched out, I suppose, in my head. Sometimes I'm not much of a thumbnail guy, but I'll do some kind of mock-up somewhere of like, okay, these are the colors I want, this, you know, so it's not, you know, aside from like the life portraits or from life, it's all thought about ahead of time.
Nice. I love Pot 66. There's a good Lutheran name. Do you ever feel like it's hard to be yourself because many people judge your art? I know people tell me I'm crazy for buying your prints because they're quote unquote creepy, but I love your work so much.
Yep.
I was just wondering how you deal with assholes or, and I guess people that judge your art.
Good question. I don't remember that person's real name, but she's bought the print for me, or I think it's she, and very grateful for that.
Yeah.
But I don't care, actually. Like, it's kind of funny to me to get a reaction out of people. I mean, a lot of my images are over the top, and I need to be, I'm totally aware of that, and I'm aware that a lot of people will be offended, shocked, think I'm weird, but that's just who I am, and I can't hide it. You know, I used to hide it, and that's not good. So now I'm just like, this is me. I love this type of stuff. I love, you know, I research this. I look at this stuff. You know, some of it, like, you'd never want to go through my phone and look through, like, the screenshots that I have of stuff. It would ruin your life forever.
I'm like, always
to get some of these.
Mariah Carey's glitter.
What's that?
Oh, God.
Geely. Oh, my God. you know, I have to research, like, okay, if I'm doing PTSD Joe of a guy that shoots himself, I got to Google shotgun death or suicide, shotgun death, you know, all these keywords. And I got to look through the right stuff to see which one is compelling to me and has a good design to it, which is super weird to think about, but like, you know, or acid attack, I've got to see all that stuff. You know, and it's reality, and it's horrible, and it's sad for people. And I've got to, you know, somehow apply some art aesthetic to it, where it's like, oh, this is the way this head is turned is perfect, mm-hmm. or you know. So I kind of have to like move away from it, but at the same time, there's just some crazy shit that you can see on the internet. Like, oh my God, horrible. Well, and it's shocking. Like sometimes it does wear me out as far as like, oh my God, like there's probably nothing you could show me right now that would shock me. That's kind of not good.
Yeah, I mean, I have some art friends that they watch those nautical videos, and those, I legitimately after one time was like, yeah, I don't feel clean right now. Like, it legitimately, not even making a joke, I felt like just don't feel clean after seeing some really nice stuff. But going back to our conversation, sometimes not encouraging it to anyone else out there before you start jumping up, you know, and blowing smoke up someone's ass. Sometimes if you do have a genuine message behind what you're doing, reading real history is not a Disney movie. It is very much those things that you have to cope with. So I agree with you, man. I agree 100%. Yeah. 100%. Let's see. Nika Kim Art asks, what is the message of your art? Do you think it is important to have a message?
I think it's important for it to connect with you. If you're a person that wants to have a message, or if you're a person that says, I want to document things in my life that are important, maybe that's my message. I don't think people need to necessarily have a clear story per se of like, I do stuff that's X, Y, and Z. But definitely make it authentic. I think that's important. You have to make it yourself. You have to make it like, you know, if you look at Keith Haring's stuff, that's that dude. Like that is his language. That is, as he gets, you know, progressively more talking about his illness and stuff, it gets more serious, but it's still his stuff. Like, that's his language. That's, you know, some people could look at it and not get anything, or like, oh, it's simple designs and it's all about spatial relationships, blah, blah, blah. Like, sure, if that's what you see, if that's what he saw, that's fine, but it was his completely. So whatever you do, make it yours. I don't think you need it, but you know, my thing is like the things in life that fascinate me, that scare me, and it's the lies that we live, the things in life that we hold near and dear that aren't true.
Grief Jerky asks, do you feel limited by what your fan base has come to expect of you and your style?
A little bit. Like, part of me, like, when I do kind of my more stylized stuff, you know, it's impossible to not pay attention to what people are liking. You know, if something gets like 8,000 likes, it's like, hey, that went pretty well. But, you know, if I do something that's a little more technical, like I did a portrait of Jeremy Lipking for this portrait I'm doing, and probably the best technical painting I've ever done and probably will ever do, and it gets half of what something I spent an hour on gets. So that's a little, and the office shouldn't give a shit about that. That's my own hang up, but that's something that's a little weird. Like, I don't post a lot of technical stuff because I don't do a lot anymore of it, but I also know it's like, well, that's not really what people want to see, I guess. So I'm kind of off the hook. I don't have to do those anymore. Is a little bit in my head. So I'm okay with it, but at the same time, I'm very interested in the fact that, like, wow, you guys didn't like that at all. You know, like, all right, back to the weird shit.
Gary Murphy, excuse me. Why do you paint? Do you feel any pressure as a painter in the 21st century contemporary society as a result of the cultural baggage that labels painting as traditional or possibly outdated with the rise of digital art? That's a very smart question.
That is. I've done digital stuff. Digital is brilliant, genius. So many things you can do with it. There's so many tricks that I think aren't good for people to learn. And I don't like that it's not real. And I don't want people to get offended by that. But I love to go up and look at a painting and say, there's that brushstroke that really existed. I love that there's only one of that painting. With digital, you can print it 10,000 times. It doesn't really exist. It's not out there in the world. I love that a painting is like, there's that one painting. The one time you put in the energy to make this thing happen, there it is. There's all the brushstrokes to make that happen. You couldn't hit undo if you didn't like it. You couldn't, you know, add blue to the whole thing to make it seem cooler. You couldn't blah, 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 you know. Like, that's it. That's the one shot you had at that. There it is. those are all the brushstrokes that made that look like it. And I don't think it's a dying thing. I think it's coming back even more because so many people jump ship to go to digital. Now people are saying, oh shit, now I want to paint. Take me back to that. Let's go back to that. I don't think that'll ever die. It's kind of like, you know, jazz or blues. Like it's always going to be there. It may be less popular or more popular, but it'll come back. You know, it's a very authentic form of expression. So painting will always be there. I think it'll go in waves of being kind of archaic and, wow, that's really hard. Can't we just hit this button and make background blue? Sure, let's do that. Mm-hmm. And so I can see the value of that for marketing and for design stuff. Yeah, you don't want to do a painting for some of that. But, you know, if you want to do a huge museum quality piece or, you know, like put some paint on it.
Yeah.
So I don't think it'll ever disappear. It'll go in waves of popularity. It's like figurative paintings will go in waves of, like, if it tells a story that's obvious, it's super cheesy to a lot of highbrow people. Whatever, that's fine.
I agree with you. If you've ever heard of the work or the artist Paul Shipper, he is the current person that does the main art for in the style of Drew Struzan. But he just recently did the Star Wars Rogue One pieces. He did Star Trek, Doctor Strange, and I spoke with him on another podcast. And
nice.
I mean, amazing dude, great, knowledgeable guy to talk to. But he said something I will never forget, because there's that big stigma of like digital versus physical. And he said it as I just kind of like how you did. He's like, you know, people need to stop acting like Photoshop is a bad word. He goes, it's a tool. And he goes, if you think people in tribes, if you gave a person in a tribe a cell phone, and you told people, I mean, even like to the Renaissance, he goes, if you told somebody that the entire knowledge of the world up to this point in time is in this tiny little device, their minds would blow, you know, they would blow a gasket. Da Vinci, all these other people, they were innovators. You know, they were people that were always looking for the newest techniques, whether it was a camera obscura? I forget the name of it. But like, you know, they would trace, they would do all these things that people shun, but they're held to this crazy standard. But at the end of the day, they were innovators. And he goes, you have that form. And back then when they were doing new techniques, people were shitting on them because it wasn't what was around, and they developed new techniques, right, and so forth. He goes, but no matter what you do, he goes, I paint digitally. You know, I do all these things. He goes, but nothing takes away from the fact that I had to learn, and I continue to enjoy physically painting something, to physically draw something.
Right.
And he goes, that will always be there. Yeah. So if you have something or you see something that is digital, remember that that is a tool, that is not an ability. Just as much as somebody is physical, he goes, no matter how much I can draw digitally, I will always come back and I will pick up a pencil, because a number two pencil versus a, you know, that's 25 cents versus a $200, let's just say, Faber-Castell pencil, not that they cost that much, is not going to make you better. The talent will be in either,
right,
you know, in the holder of that one. But I agree with you, man.
Right.
No matter what, you're always going to come back to it. Let's see. David Chaffetz. All right, my boy. David asked.
Hey, nice.
David asked, I feel the biggest factor aside from skill in a successful art career is the willingness to hustle all day, every day. You successfully juggle two careers and family. If you talked about your schedule, your time management, and your grind, I think you would be, I think people would be very inspired. Now, just to clarify, I know that you said that you wanted to kind of keep it just on the art. Within respects to what you were asking, how do you manage everything? Because like the biggest thing I think people are going to be shocked by is that you only paint, obviously, on and off over the years, but you only do an hour here or 2 hours there or so forth.
Right. Yeah. And, you know, and if you follow his page, like that dude is super passionate about stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And it's contagious, and to want to be like him and paint as much as he is, that's a goal, with the level of consistency that he has. So he's got it. He definitely does. So I think something that he would understand a lot, you would understand lots of artists where, like, it's not something you want to do. It's something you have to do. And in fact, you're compelled to do. And when it's not in your life, you feel less than. Sometimes you don't recognize why you don't feel as good, but like art is something you just have to do. You have to fit it in. You will fit it in. And it's almost sweeter if you've got so many things going on and it's like, okay, I've got 2 hours. I can make as much damage as possible. Let's do it. I have an incredibly full life. Work, family, you name it, it's full. And last year, I really only could paint like 2 or 3 days a week for maybe 2 hours at a time. And then, you know, from like 10 o'clock to midnight, and then I'd sleep, get up, be super tired, sleep it off the next day, try it again the next day, and just with limited time, and just see how much you can do, and just know that, like, okay, I checked in with it and I did it. I feel better. And then you can't wait to get to it the next time. Sometimes the worst thing you can have is too much time and you squander it. But again, it's something, if you're just born to do it, if you're born to play guitar, if you're born to tattoo, if you're born to sell stocks, like, it, you just have to have it where there's no other option for you. Like, this is what you're going to do. You know, and I tell a lot of people, I wish I had something else that drove me, but this is it. Cause you know, art is such a fickle, weird thing. It's a luxury to sell art. You know, nobody needs art. It's not like food. It's not like transportation. It's not like housing. Like, it's like jewelry. Nobody needs it. If you can afford it, that means you've done pretty well, and it's a luxury. I kind of always remind myself that, like, I'll do these paintings. It's like, it's not going to sell, and it doesn't have to, and that's okay. But at the same time, I wish I was into selling stocks and doing all that money making shit, because that life would be a lot easier, but it's not how I was built. So it's just, the hustle has to be part of you.
That goes to the last question, which ties into this one very well. I, Daniela, and thank you, David, for that question. Hope to have you on here soon, brother. Do you believe that you found what you want to do for the rest of your life? Or do you think that there's something else out there for you? I like this question specifically just because, like you said with David, David is consistently working, consistently grinding, painting all the time, and, you know, loving it. And there are other artists that enjoy doing it, you know, periodically. And maybe it's not what they want to do I don't want to say for the rest of their life, but that's not the main thing they want to do.
Right.
How do you feel?
Art is always going to be the big thing. It's the common thread in my whole life. If it's tattooing, if it's painting portraits, if it, you know, whatever wave I'm into at that time or that season of my life, it'll always have an art focus. Maybe I'm doing, you know, I did music for a while. Maybe it's making videos, but at some level, it's a creative outlet, mostly based on two-dimensional visual stuff. So, yeah, I mean, this is it. This is kind of what I've been put on the planet to do, I think.
Nice. Blake, thank you so much, dude, for taking the time.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, man, I'm meeting one of my heroes, which is awesome. But two, just to sit down, man, and conversing with you for the past few days, you know, via Instagram and on the phone, has been like, you're a genuinely kind guy. You love what you do. You're funny and not gonna lie, quite handsome. But you're a cool dude, man. And to me, the most important
thing. Thank you very much. Likewise.
Oh, thanks. Thanks. But in reality, I've speaking with World of Pencils, coming from another podcast as well. It's different because they have such a greater reach, but I made it a point that you know, there are many artists out there that do amazing things, but the biggest thing I'd like to focus on, especially towards other people, and I don't care if anyone finds it freaking cheesy, is I like to talk to people who are naturally, you know, kind people or people that are genuine. You know what I mean? People that when you talk to them, you're going to get a genuine person, because, you know, the worst thing in the world is to admire somebody, go to see them at a gallery or something, and then they're just like, out of my way, chunky. And not that that's ever happened.
Yeah, I know exactly what you mean.
But you are a awesome dude. Your work is going far so quick, and I hope it goes further. Myself and everyone else, man, at World of Pencils loves and supports you, man. I would like you to share.
Thank you very much.
Of course, anytime, man. I hope to have you back again in the future. And I want you to share any places that people can find you via Instagram, via website, if they would like to purchase any of your prints or originals, whatever you're into. Plug away, my friend.
Sure. Instagram, Blake Neubert. Facebook, Blake Neubert. I'm very creative with my titles. Right now, my website is getting flipped around. It was cavitycreep.squarespace.com just because it was a store, but BlakeNeubert.com will be up pretty soon. So keep an eye out for that one.
Nice. And is there anything else that you want to say to the people out there in Podcastlandia?
Thanks for having me on here, man. It was a pleasure, and I appreciate everybody asking questions and giving a shit about what I do. It means the world to me.
And thanks for some of the other questions we didn't get to. Those ones were pretty funny.
I'll probably go ahead and answer all those. They were pretty good.
So as for anyone else out there that's listening, you can subscribe to us on iTunes under World of Pencils Podcast. Please go out there and support Blake and other artists we are going to have on here. Without you guys, you know, supporting and sharing art, a lot of these artists wouldn't be able to share with you their experiences, their techniques, and everything else. And more than anything else, again, we thank you, Blake. We thank everyone else listening and out there on Instagram, iTunes, Amazon, the whole shebang-a-bang. And always remember to, you know, stay true to the art, and we'll see you next week.
Thanks, everyone.